Dates back to years and years and years ago when Junior actually raced here. You know, he was awful tough on this racetrack himself when it was dirt. And he was tough on all the short tracks as a driver. And I think it sort of, it shows up in our race card. We've always been able to run really well on short tracks. Martinsville, Bristol, Nashville, everywhere we ever went on a short track, the car always seemed to be a little quicker than everybody else's.
Darrell's most recent win was in the fall race in 1984. He beat Harry Gant and Bobby Allison en route to the Holly Farms crown. The Johnson cars were 1-2 at the spring race last year, with Bonnet chalking up win number 15 for Junior's cars at North Wilkesboro overall. He doesn't own North Wilkesboro Speedway, but his record speaks for itself. And they've even named the densely populated backstretch grandstand for Junior Johnson. Speedway in North Carolina on a cloudy Sunday afternoon. The temperature is 73 degrees. Humidity 35%. We have a 40% chance of rain today, and it's rather windy, with winds from the southwest at 25 to 30 miles an hour. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Bob Jenkins, and welcome to the first Union 400 Winston Cup race, the seventh for 1986. The story so far this weekend here at North Wilkesboro has been qualifying and the performance of Richard Petty. He came close but did not capture the pole for today's race. With me in the booth working the event today, Larry Neuber, and instead, Larry, Jeff Bonine on the pole.
Bob, in all of racing, it's been a heartwarming season. We have seen Kevin Cogan and Michael Andretti win their first races in Indy cars. The vet has finally won an IMSA. And this week, Richard Petty came here to North Wilkesboro, not expecting to go for the pole, but they were so fast they had no choice. But Jeff Bodine, admitting there were some tugs at his heart, beat Richard out for the pole. But I think it does point out how evenly matched everybody is this year. Why, I think Parsons is even going to win this year.
And also with us in the booth for today's race is Benny Parsons, Winston Cup competitor. And Benny, there's certainly no favorite for today's race.
Oh, there isn't a favorite because, and as you mentioned in the opening of the show, for the past 10 years, Junior Johnson's cars have been dominant here. They've won about everything. But I started racing at this track in 1970, and for the next 5 or 6 years, there was a fella almost impossible to beat, Richard Petty. As Larry mentioned, he's starting second today. He has a chance. But when we talk about 1986, we got to mention Dale Earnhardt. There's been about 2,500 miles of racing competition in 1986. Earnhardt has led around 1,100 miles, almost half of them. Certainly, he has an opportunity today.
All right, and also working with us today in the pit area will be Jack Arut. Let's go to Jack for more on this front row, Jeff Bodine and Richard Petty.
Well, gentlemen, as Bob Uecker would say, the front row had a couple of surprises. One on the inside wasn't a surprise. Jeff Bodine snared his third bush pole of the year. But this fellow standing next to me came this close to winning his first since 1979. Richard Petty, the two-day qualifying did you in. That first day, you had the fastest lap.
Well, we had the fastest lap first day, and if, you know, if we were a little bit faster, we could have the fastest lap second day. But, you know, we were real pleased with qualifying as good as we did. So, you know, you don't want to get too greedy. It's been so long since we've been this close. We'll just take this.
Well, hey, listen, the way things have been going the last couple of weeks, the guy on the pole hasn't come up through the gearbox quick enough, and the guy on the outside leads going into the first turn.
Well, I'm kind of slow on that, too, so me and him probably have a good start on this one.
How about your running here at North Wilkesboro? Do you think you've really got a legitimate shot, what with your injured shoulder and the problems that you've had over the last couple of weeks?
Well, yeah, we seem like we do. We feel like if the car's very capable of taking care of the thing, and, you know, it's just a 400-lap race. So, you know, if everything goes right, I should be able to make it okay. So we feel like we've got a super good chance.
Confidence coming from Richard Petty, the kind of confidence we haven't seen since maybe 1979.
The King is back and could very well be a factor in today's first Union 400, which is being brought to you by... Track here at North Wilkesboro is 5/8 of a mile as the field begins to pull away on first about three pace laps to get the cars heated up. The turns are 660 feet, the straightaways are 990 feet, banking on the turns 14 degrees, and the racetrack is about 75 feet wide. The seating capacity here is 18,000, and just about every seat is taken for today's race. Now a look at the starting lineup for the first Union 400. On the pole, qualifying at 112.419 in the Levi Garrett Chevrolet car number 5 from Chemung, New York, his third straight pole position, Jeff Bodine. Out outside of row number one. From Randleman, North Carolina, in the STP Pontiac Car 43, Richard Petty. In the second row, the Folgers Coffee Chevrolet Car 25, Tim Richmond from Ashland, Ohio. And on the outside of the second row will be Terry Labonte from Corpus Christi, Texas, and the number 44 Piedmont Airlines Oldsmobile. The third row, from Kannapolis, North Carolina, Dale Earnhardt in the Wrangler Jean Chevrolet Car number 3, and Bobby Allison from Hueytown, Alabama, in the number 22 Miller American Buick. In the fourth row, from Upland, California, Joe Rutman, the Quaker State Buick Car number 26. Outside the fourth row, starting eighth, will be the Budweiser Chevrolet Car 12, driven by Neil Bonnet from Hueytown, Alabama. In row number 6, Kyle Petty from Randleman, North Carolina, in the 7-Eleven Ford Car number 7. And then outside of row number 5 will be Darrell Waltrip from Franklin, Tennessee, in the number 11 Budweiser Chevrolet. Row number 6, Ken Schrader from Fenton, Missouri, in car number 90, and Alan Kowicki in 35. The 7th row, Bill Elliott in number 9, and Ricky Rudd in 15. The 8th row, Rusty Wallace in 27, and Gary Gann in 33. Row number 9, Jody Ridley in 75, and Ron Bouchard in 98. The 10th row, Bobby Hillen Jr. in car number 8, and Doug Cameron in 17. In the 11th row, Dave Marcus and Morgan Shepherd. Row number 12, Chet Phillips and Mike Waltrip. In row number 13, Buddy Arrington, car 67, J.D. McDuffie, number 70. In the 14th row, Trevor Boys in car number 6, and Jimmy Means in number 52. And in the last row number 15, Willie T. Ribbs in car number 30, and Rick Baldwin in 64. Willie T. Ribbs becomes the third black driver to make the field for a Winston Cup race. The field comes off of corner number 4, Jeff Bodine. Leads them across, the green flag is out, and the first Union 400 is underway from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. Well, we have seen Jeff Bodine experience problems the last couple of races at the start of the race, but that was not the case today, as he was leading coming off of corner number 4, and he is going to lead lap number 1.
Richard Petty trying to get under the Tim Richmond automobile, which got by him on the start. Richard was alongside of him down in 1 and 2 and takes the spot away. Earnhardt trying to follow him through on the inside.
So Richard Petty moves into second. Dale Earnhardt now into third. And Joe Rutman sneaking up into fourth position as Tim Richmond is lagging behind here after a good start and falling into second spot. He's now back to fifth.
Richmond just doesn't seem to be working. Bodine got the start over Richard Petty. And Richmond, you can see him getting a little bit out of shape once again going through turns 1 and 2. He had second place. He held back the whole field, but now everybody is getting by.
Bodine off of corner number 4 leading the race with Richard Petty in second. A lot of traffic behind the front runners, but everybody in good shape so far. It's a tight 5/8 mile racetrack that they run on. There is Darrell Waltrip trying to move up on the outside.
On the outside, and we already saw Tim Richmond right on the outside. He couldn't go anyplace, but Waltrip is making some headway out there. Here he's alongside Richmond as they come off turn 4.
And he is trying to move into 7th position. Right now, Tim Richmond is in 7th and Darrell Waltrip in 8th. But Waltrip on the outside running door handle with Tim Richmond. They come off the second corner and go down the back stretch. And Darrell Waltrip does move into 7th position. Now Terry Labonte wants to pass Tim Richmond.
What Tim Richmond needs is a caution flag here in the first 10 laps. Something is just not exactly the way it was all week long, and particularly yesterday when they qualified. Benny, there is Joe Rutman. He just passed Earnhardt. He's running well.
Joe Rutman, last week at Darlington, had a good run, and here again today, third spot. Great beginning for Joe Rutman.
Well, you remember last weekend when Joe Rutman moved up into a high place right at the beginning of the race was partially caused by the Jeff Bodine problem at the beginning, but this week he is just moving up very quickly on Richard Petty as we watch Terry Labonte, who is currently in 8th spot.
It's Bodine, Petty, Rutman first three, then Earnhardt, Bonnet, Kyle Petty, Waltrip, Terry Labonte, Tim Richmond, Bobby Allison, Kenny Schrader is up there, then Bill Elliott. See who else is up there. Next is Rusty Wallace, then Jody Ridley. Those are the top 15 cars, so it's a very early point.
Bobby Allison there running between Tim Richmond and Ken Schrader. A good starting position for Bobby Allison. He was the 6th fastest qualifier, checking in with a 111.627. We should say Grandpa Bobby Allison. His daughter had a baby just a couple of days ago.
They
Kenny, the interesting thing about this year, the story has continued this week. Everybody agrees there must be at least 15 cars who can win this race. There is definitely not anywhere near a clear-cut favorite.
No, there isn't a favorite. Richard Petty, I think, is the sentimental favorite. As you mentioned, Jeff O'Neill took the pole away from Richard Petty. He really hated to do it. I think if Richard has a shot with the last 50 miles, certainly they're not going to give it to him. But when it's over, if Richard Petty could win the race, I think everyone would say, good for him.
Yeah, Jeff told us yesterday, right after he took the pole from Richard, that he actually thought about it during the qualifying run. Gee, this is Richard's best chance in like 6 years. Do I really want to do this? He said, the professional am, I had to go for it.
But look at Richard Petty. He's only two car lengths behind Jeff Bodine. He was 15 just a couple of laps ago. And we see the damage. The damage on the right front of Richard Petty's car. He hit Tim Richmond the first lap of the race, which caused that damage, but it doesn't look to be severe enough to have to make a pit stop.
And Richmond is out of shape, and turn number two almost spins coming off of the second corner. Let's go down to Jack Arute, who has more on this Tim Richmond problem.
Bob, here's the situation about Tim Richmond's car. They thought at first he might have a tire going down, and that was causing it to be very, very loose. They surveyed it by their pit. They said, no, the tire's not going down. But they did set the car up with loose springs. And Benny Parsons can tell you more about that. That could be the problem right now.
Well, how about it, Benny? How do you set a car up for North Wilkesboro?
Well, I think that this weekend has been a very unusual weekend because they're running a tire combination unlike anything they've ever used before. No one really knows what springs to run. I think that a lot of cars are going to have the same problem that Richmond has. That's trying to spin out or get loose coming off the turn. I don't think Tim Richmond has the problem right now, but I think we're going to see the problem with everyone before it's over. Look at Richard Pettibone.
He's on the corner number two and challenging Jeff Bodine for the lead as they go down the back stretch and into corner number three. Richard Petty to the inside of Jeff Bodine, and they touch coming off of the fourth corner, and they cross the start-finish line side-by-side. I believe Bodine had the slight advantage on that lap, but let's see what Richard does now as they once again come off the second corner. Petty pulls ahead of Bodine.
Bob, I got to tell you that, Benny, I have not seen the NASCAR fans be this excited in a long, long time. This reminds me of being in Brazil when the home country people were cheering Ayrton Senna. The fans are going wild.
You know, Bob mentioned at the top of the show, there's 18,000 seats here, and I think every one of them cheered when Richard Petty went by.
I think you're right. A tremendous round of applause for the king, Richard Petty, who has been so good this weekend here at North Wilkesboro. He's leading Jeff Bodine now as we've completed 17 laps of this 400-lap race at North Wilkesboro.
Another guy who's running into the top 10. I think we missed him on the rundown a few laps ago. Those of you who are from the Chesapeake, Virginia area wonder, hey, where's Ricky Rudd? Well, he's in there. Petty continues to lead. Bodine is second. And by the way, Joe Ruttman has closed up. Joe Ruttman is only a couple car lengths behind, but Rudd's also still competitive today.
Richard Petty's starting to wiggle just a little bit off turn four, but finds that his car is getting loose. Not as perfect as it was the first couple of laps.
There are your first three. Richard Petty leading Jeff Bodine in second position, and Joe Ruttman is in third. Fourth would be Neil Bonnet. In fifth place, Dale Earnhardt. Sixth is Darrell Waltrip. Seventh is Kyle Petty. Eighth, Terry Labonte. Ninth, Bobby Allison. And in tenth position is Ricky Rudd. Now the leaders already approaching some of the slower traffic. Down the back stretch, they move high and pass Rick Baldwin driving car number 64. Now they approach Jimmy Means in 52 and Willie T. Ribbs, who's driving that white car number 30.
You know, as we watch Richard Petty, think about this, Benny. How many people watching this broadcast are under the age of 28? It was 28 years ago that Richard Petty first showed up at this racetrack as a Winston Cup driver.
Oh, that's unbelievable. He's been doing it so long, and yet 28 years later, he's leading this event.
And that's something.
Randall, the North Carolina's Richard Petty. We had an opportunity to talk to him earlier this weekend about his chances for winning here.
Will tomorrow's race be your best shot at victory since, as President Reagan called it, the fire cracked 400 years ago?
Well, I don't know. Right now, yeah, we're sitting in the best position to start a race that we have since then. So, you know, the next thing is pretty good, but we ran short track first in better because we ran good at Bristol, and the drivers give out, and I think that if we keep everything together here, I think this is one of our better racetracks, so from that standpoint, it should be a good second.
He's in good shape right now. He's leading Jeff Bodine and Joe Ruttman in the Union Bank 4
beginning to challenge for second position. He's high on the racetrack, moving alongside Jeff Bodine. Good racing here in the early stages of this event. We'll be back to have more in just a moment. 30 laps have been completed here in North Wilkesboro, and we have had a change of the standings in the top three. Jeff Bodine is back on top. Joe Rutman is in second position, and Richard Petty clear back to third. This is how the change of positions occurred.
There was Super Bodine going down the back straightaway, and in turn three, he's on the bottom of the racetrack, which is clearly the fastest way around. Joe Rutman follows, and on the inside, there's nothing Richard Petty can do except relinquish the racetrack because of the car already. They're already.
Well, Bob, Richard actually has slowed down a little bit because Neil Bonnet running in fourth and Dale Earnhardt running in fifth have closed in on Richard. And meanwhile, Bodine right there and Rutman, the first two cars, have opened up about five or six car lengths on Richard. And for a while, we were all talking during the break. It looked like the Rutman was the fastest car in the racetrack, but now that Bodine has the vanguard and the clear track, he seems to be sailing better than everybody else.
I don't know. Joe Rutman is right there. He's only a car length back. Right now, the Bodine car and Rutman car very evenly matched.
Joe Rutman started in seventh spot, qualifying about 1.2 miles an hour off the full speed, but he is already up into second spot. And here is Rusty Wallace in the Alugard Pontiac coming in for an early stop. Of course, Rusty, the winner earlier this year in Bristol. Let's go to Jackaroos.
And he is visibly upset. He had a flat on the right, on the left rear, and they had to bring him in to change the Goodyear tire. A quick stop to grab some fuel, but it's been costly this early in the race.
It was a very quick stop, but when you're under green, there's not much you can do except lose a lap. He was in 11th position when he had to come in for that stop.
And he could have waited a little longer. They could have maybe stretched the point and considered that to be a routine stop. But, Benny, it was much too early to be calling a routine.
Yes, it's much too early. And when the tires go flat, it's going to cost you so much time. It changes the handling characteristics of the car so much, he simply had to come in and change the tire.
Rusty moving there under the number 48 car, which is being driven this weekend by Morgan Shepherd, who, of course, was the winner at Atlanta earlier this year. Morgan today is driving the Bird Rucky Chevrolet owned by James Hilton. Now we're watching Dale Earnhardt and Richard Petty going at it out there, and Dale has made the pass and moved into fourth spot.
Richard Petty, the handling is going away. He's just drifting back more and more each time. There he's losing several car lengths to Earnhardt down the back straightaway. I would expect to see Richard Petty in the fifth pretty soon. Jackaroo might check with Dale Inman.
And remember, Bonnet has already got by. There's still about 20 cars that are running competitively and easily on the lead lap. Wallace, of course, losing one. But Bonnet and Earnhardt have pulled away from Richard.
And the next driver that will be moving up to challenge Richard Petty for a spot is Darrell Waltrip and also Bobby Allison. You can see the two cars right behind Richard as he comes off the fourth corner. That's Waltrip right behind Richard and Bobby Allison right behind Darrell.
This racetrack sets up, at least we have seen in recent years, different kinds of strategy, Benny, because it has a habit of going 100, 150 laps all under green flag, and it really puts an added emphasis on the ability to make a judgment before the green flag starts. What do we do to this race car to make it handle 50 laps down the road?
Exactly right, Larry, and I tell you what, Richard Petty right now, I tell you, Jack Arruda has talked to Dale Inman. He has a report for us. Jack?
Well, that's right, Benny, and the tires, the story, at least at this point in time, they're not sure exactly why he's dropping back, but they brought up the question that we alluded to, me and you, about the use of the same hard compound on the right side and the left side here for North Wilkesboro. That's a departure from normal circumstances, and these extra hard tires are really making crew chiefs dig deep into their bag of tricks in terms of spring setup and chassis selection. And right now, they tend to think that these hard tires, when they got hot, have lost a little bit of adhesion that they had on the left side, and they're causing problems.
Jack is talking about hard tires. At most of the racetracks we go to, of the oval tracks, as we can see, all the cars are going to the left. The right side of the automobile takes a harder tire. The compound on the tire is harder on the right than the left. This weekend at North Wilkesboro, the Goodyear tire engineers have put the same tire all the way around at all four locations. And that's something these fellas just aren't used to, and how they are able to attack that problem is yet to be seen.
Now, Jeff Bodine has passed Tim Richmond and put a lap on him. Tim was running in 20th position, so 19 cars are now on the lead lap.
Harry Gann and Terry Labonte, they're running out there about in 10th position. Like I said, there's still around 20 competitive cars yet. And Gann and Labonte have run strong all day long. They're running together. Maybe it's the pace that they want to run. That tire situation, we saw it yesterday, by the way, in the modified race, which, by the way, was run by Jan Lacy, one of the northern invaders who came down and beat the southerners. But young Frank Fleming had the fastest tire on the racetrack. They had tire problems late in the 150-lap race, but ironically enough, it was on the inside rear tire, not the outside. Doug Heffron is spinning in turn four. He's going to save it. I think he's got it right in front of the leader, Bodine.
Yes, Bodine was right behind Heffron as that car got swirly at him coming out of turn number four, but he saved it, and everything is okay. The green stays out.
That was a close call for Jeff Bodine, the leader. From Heffron went sideways all the way through turns three and four, but as we can see, Jeff Bodine got by with no problem whatsoever.
And Bodine is the leader of the first Union 400 at North Wilkesboro. We'll resume our coverage right after these messages. With Benny Parsons, Larry Newmer, and Jack Arrow, this is Bob Jenkins at North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina for the first Union 400, where Jeff Bodine has led 39 of the 51 laps. Second position is a battle between Neil Bonnet and Joe Ruttman, and right now Neil Bonnet has that spot. Now, while we were away, Richard Petty, who started this race from outside front row, came in for a pit stop. The right rear on that car had gone flat, and Joe Ruttman with a little bit of a handling problem there in turn number two. Let's go to Jackaroo for a recap of Petty's problem.
Well, you're looking at the tire off the right rear of the SEV Pontiac. The Goodyear engineers come over and inspect them immediately. And here's what they found. A very small, maybe an eighth of an inch cut in the tire. It dropped all of the air out of it and also dropped Richard Petty off the lead lap. A tough break, both for Goodyear and for Petty.
It is indeed. So Richard Petty a lap down now. And we've got some great racing going on for position out there. Darrell Waltrip, Ricky Rudd, and Kyle Petty are going at it for 6th, 7th, and 8th positions.
Pretty obvious. We're in another one of those long green flag segments at North Wilkesboro, and that list of drivers all in the lead lap, there is Bodine continuing to lead, putting one lap on Jody Ridley, who obviously up to this moment was on the lead lap, has now shrunk down to about 14 or 15 cars. There is Dale Earnhardt moving up. He has moved under Joe Ruttman, who seems to be backing up just a bit. And Bobby Allison, remember, who led so many laps here a year ago, is also moving under Ruttman. And by the way, Richmond has come into the pits as we speak.
Lights to a halt, and they go to work on the car. We go to Jackaroo.
Again, some tire problems with the Richmond machine. You can see one of the crew members is going through the window and moving the wedge on the race car, trying to make the tires work better. That would not have been a normally scheduled pit stop, but with the tires causing them these kind of problems early on, they can get in and we'll work our way back to the front.
Jackaroo can check with the crew. I'm speculating that Tim Richmond did not have a flat tire or a tire problem. That car was lifted so loose that he needed to stop, get on tires, and make that chassis adjustment. We saw that fellow reach in the left rear of that car. It seemed like he turned that bolt for a long, long time.
So Jeff Bodine is now running by himself. He has moved through traffic and has a full straightaway between himself and the next car that he will lap. That is Trevor Boyd's machine. Neil Bonnet is running in second. Dale Earnhardt has moved into third.
Yeah, Jack, maybe you can follow up on this, but we're at that point in the race where this is about the earliest that you can stop in call-up routines. So like Benny said, maybe they decided, boy, they've waited long enough. We've had enough of this setup. Let's bring in Tim now.
Well, Benny, actually what happened wasn't that the tires were going down. The tires were no longer working, as you speculated. I checked with Harry Hyde. That's why they brought him in early. Let's make the chassis adjustment, put new rocks on the outside, and get back to racing while we have plenty of time to make up the lost ground.
And I think that's probably a good decision on Harry Hyde's part to bring him in, because if it kept him out there for another 50 or 60 laps, he could lose a couple of more laps. As it was, he lost one lap, and I don't know where he is on the racetrack right now, but he probably is as fast as anyone on the speedway.
There we see Bobby Allison. What a great run he's having so far. And this is second, third, and fourth. Neil Bonnet, Dale Earnhardt, and Bobby Allison.
Let's talk a little bit, guys, about that streak that has been well-publicized. Total number of different winners in recent races. Right now, it stands at 11. Earnhardt could have created a new chain when he won last week. Now, here's the guys who can win today shot at it. Rudd has certainly got a shot at it. I'd say Bonnet. Now, Petty and Richmond aren't out of it, but their chances seem to be good.
Look at Bobby Allison go by Dale Earnhardt. And folks, we're seeing history, mate. Nobody has passed Dale Earnhardt this year.
That's a good point. Dale has led both laps this year and, of course, won last weekend in Darlington. But here this weekend, things have not gone especially good for him. He was fifth fastest qualifier, and now he has just been passed by Bobby Allison for third position.
He hadn't forgotten, though. He didn't remember how to do that, though. Despite since the long time it happened, he did all right.
But I tell you, Earnhardt has a good pit crew. Richard Field and his guys, they're down there working right now. They'll figure out how to get that three car around the racetrack.
Well, it's very early in this 400 lap race. We have completed just 65 laps. We have gone all green so far. No caution flags, although there has been a couple of close calls out there on the track. And Doug Heffron was among those who got loose and almost caught, but was able to save it. So all green to this point.
Neil Bonnet on your screen right there, the number 12 car. It's been somewhat of a frustrating season for them. They've had much too many crashes. I think they've had, like, what, Benny? Four cars they have wiped out so far in 1986. He's on one of the acknowledged, if not the acknowledged, best team in Winston Cup stock car racing right now. And I'm sure that Neil and all the guys who are involved in this know that the potential is there. Certainly we have seen Neil has proven himself to be one of the best athletes in stock car racing.
And I tell you what, no one in the last 2 months of racing has worked any harder than Neil Bonnet's crew. Because as you mentioned, they've been to every one of these racetracks. They even went to Bristol twice, to Darlington twice in Destin to make sure that they would have a good race car. Bristol, what happened? The throttle on, he destroyed a race car.
And Bob and Benny, after the Atlanta race, they talked briefly with Tim Brewer on the phone, and he said, we're never going to be as bad as they perceive that they were in Atlanta. We are going to work harder than we've ever worked in our life, and we're never going to turn in a performance like that. So they have really been trying to concentrate on turning in an outstanding performance. It looks like Neil may have a shot at one today.
That is a race for second spot. Bobby Allison has passed Neil Bonnet on the outside, has second place. He's got his eyes set on Jeff Bodine right now.
Performance by Bobby Allison here in the early going. Neil Bonnet dropping back to third, and there the other car in the picture is the fourth place machine of Dale Earnhardt. There is the leader, Jeff Bodine. He comes off of corner number four and crosses the line, and the interval between himself and second place is about a half a straightaway.
It's all beginning to filter out now. It's got to be a little confusing for those of you at home, as a number of people have been lapped. We're trying to give you a rundown as quickly as we can here, but we're down to about 10 cars and 10 cars only that are on the lead lap. And I got to tell you, there aren't too many surprises. The normal guys need to be up there.
So we'll be back with our live coverage of stop number 7 in the Winston Cup Trail for 1986, the first Union 400 from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. 76 laps have been completed in the first Union 400 here in North Wilkesboro, live on ESPN this Sunday afternoon. Jeff Bodine, the pole sitter, has led 65 of the 75 laps. The other laps were led by Richard Petty, who has since come in for a pit stop and lost a lap. Bodine to the outside of Willie T. Ribbs and lapping him for the second time this afternoon.
Well, here's the rundown that very unofficial that we kind of alluded to as we look at Ricky Rudd there, number 15, red white almost identical to Darrell Waltham. Bodine, Chevy, Allison, Buick, Bonnet, Chevrolet, Earnhardt, Chevrolet, and in fifth place is Joe Ruffin. And two of the three Buicks that have entered the racer today running the top five. Six unofficially is Waltrip. Seventh is the first Ford of Ricky Rudd. Eighth is Harry Gant. Ninth is Kyle Petty. Tenth is Labonte. Bobby Helen. And the third Buick is 11th. So the only three Buicks that are here, they all three run in the top 11. Elliott is 12th and Bouchard and Pontiac is 13th. Those are the only people that remain on the pace setting lead lap.
Caution flag is out on the racetrack. We look around and don't see a car that has spun. so we'll stand by to get the official word as to why this caution period has come out, but it comes out with 79 laps completed, and it's for debris on the racetrack, and it causes the leaders to head for pit road. Here comes Jeff Bodine, Bobby Allison, Neil Bonnet, Dale Earnhardt, Joe Ruttman, Darrell Waltrip, and others. Jack is at the Jeff Bodine pit.
And the Levi Garrett crew goes to work on the outside, right side rubber being exchanged. They're taking on the first 11 gallons of Union 76 crew fuel. They drop the jack. Yes, they're going to make it a four-tire change under caution. They come back around. They've dropped a lug wrench, and they did not finish the work on the right side. This is going to be costly for them. Thank goodness it's under caution. They finished that exchange on the right side. Now they're back on the left side, removing the tires. The final left rear tire goes on. The lug nuts being attached by the rear wrench. Jeff Smith looking aggressively ahead, waiting for the signal to go. They drop it, and he hangs away.
He was the last one out of the pit, Jack. The guy with the best pit stop was Kyle Petty. He was first out, followed by Dale Earnhardt and Bobby Allison. But Kyle Petty is coming in for a second time.
Well, probably Kyle Petty only changed two tires on that pit stop. He needs to change four like all the rest of the leaders did. We saw the graphic on the screen that Jeff Bodine's pit stop was 40 seconds. And that's a real long time in Winston Cup racing. Normally, they do those stops in somewhere between 25 and 30 seconds. And yes, Kyle Petty is back in, and they're changing the left side of the Ford at this time.
And the car right ahead of Kyle Petty's in the pit area, Ron Bouchard, the number 98 Valvoline Pontiac, was black flag during this caution.
I can't imagine what he was black flagged for, because it was on green flag racing.
Well, everybody is continuing to use this extra opportunity. There you see Lee Ritz coming into the pit with the red roof in. Henley Gray rented from a car, that's Henley's car, but it is the Dygar people who put it together, and Willie T's good friend and mentor, Jim Truman, has come through with the Red Rift sponsorship to get Willie into this Winston Cup deal. There you see Kenny Schrader, the number 90, he falls into the pit area. DK Ulrich, number 6 car. By the way, one of the finest looking paint jobs I've seen on DK car in some time. Nice little fire in red.
There comes Willie T back on the racetrack. Did you see all those cars in the pit and all those people? We have a radio hookup with Tim Richmond today. They're going to throw the green flag right away. Let's try it. Tim Richmond, this is the ESPN control. Do you read me?
Yeah, go ahead. I got you loud and clear.
What was wrong with the car to begin with?
I don't know. I wish I did know. It's screwed up. There's no doubt about that.
Disregarding the fact that the green has come out, he is continuing to talk with us and trying to explain the problem that he has experienced here in the early going of this race. Right now he's behind Jeff Bodine, but that car still just does not appear to be handling all that well.
I gotta tell you guys, a rare glimpse into the psyche of a race driver. Tim Richmond takes the green flag and keeps up his conversation with us, racing 2 and 3 abreast all the way around this racetrack, and trying to describe the action for all those of you at home watching.
That was most impressive, I'll tell you that. I can't imagine him running a complete green flag lap while talking to us. As we can see, after the exchange of pit stops, Dale Earnhardt has the lead, and right behind him, Richard Petty, a lap down.
And so is Rusty Wallace, a lap down, who is third on the track. Running second in the race is the fourth car back at Darrell Walter.
And those two cars, Richard Petty and Rusty Wallace, need to get by.
And a car has spun and hit the wall up in turn number 4. That's the number 6 of Trevor Boys from Calgary, Alberta. The car to the inside of the racetrack at the entrance to pit road. The yellow flag is not being displayed because that car is off of the racetrack.
Well, another reason, Bob and Benny, is that where he is stopped, he is out of the way. And to throw the yellow flag and to entice everybody to come in would not be a safe moment, because he is right in front.
The wrecker is moving out to get the car off pit road, and they still haven't thrown the caution flag.
I'm kind of surprised at this, but the racing continues on. Green flag.
And Dale Earnhardt continues to set the pace now as he is pulling away from the rest of the field, including Richard Petty, who's a lap down, and Darrell Waltrip, who's in second place.
One little quick pit note. Ron Bouchard was at the very end of the lead lap as we're watching Waltrip and Allison battling up front. He was held in the pit during the last caution flag for a minor infraction. We do not know yet whether or not Bouchard has remained in the lead lap.
What Bouchard did was that he had been lapped, and he passed the leader. When the caution flag came out, Jeff Bodine slowed down. Ron Bouchard passed him, what NASCAR called it, under the caution flag. So they penalized him for doing that. So, yes, he is a lap down.
We're watching 2, 3, 4, and 5 here. That's Darrell Waltrip at number 11, Bobby Allison at 22, Joe Rutman in the green, number 26, and then behind him is Ricky Rudd. They're fighting for position, and Rutman goes inside of Bobby Allison in the third turn and moves into third.
The way that Bobby Allison gave that spot away, I think Bobby has his car is not handling as well, certainly as he might support him right now, because he gave that spot away too easily to Joe Rutman, which means that he's going to get down and race with him because really not comfortable doing it.
And now we're watching Ricky Rudd move up on the back bumper of Bobby Allison and challenge for position. 93 laps have been completed. We're almost at the one-quarter mark already. For the most part, all green racing except for a brief moment when there was debris on the racetrack. We'll be back in just a moment with more of this Winston Cup race. And at this race, it is Dale Earnhardt in command at the moment with 99 laps completed. Next time around, it'll be 100 and a fourth of the race completed. Second place now belongs to Joe Rutman. In third is Darrell Waltrip. Fourth, Bobby Allison. Fifth, Ricky Rudd. Sixth is Neil Bonnet. Seventh, Harry Gant. In eighth position is Jeff Bodine. And in ninth spot is Kyle Petty.
A couple of notes of interest on that leaderboard. Bobby Hillen Jr. and Bill Elliott have been able to remain on the lead lap amidst all this confusion. There's so much talk about Bill being relatively weak in the short track. He has only had really one sterling performance in the last two or three years in the short track, but he has held on to that lead lap as well as Bobby Hillen Jr. in 11th and 12th right now.
Yeah, we do have 12 cars on the lead lap. I gave you the top nine. 10 belongs to Terry Labonte. In 11th is Bill Elliott, and 12th Bobby Hillen Jr. There is Ricky Rudd in fifth position in that motorcraft board.
Bobby Allison, who is right directly in front of Ricky Rudd in the red and white. Well, there's four red and white cars right in a row. The 15 car is Ricky Rudd. The car of the 22 is Bobby Allison. 11 is Darrell Walker. Bobby Allison a few moments ago was drifting back, but I don't know what has happened. Right now, he seems to be maintaining his speed along with the rest of the cars.
And that is Rusty Wallace that these guys are lapping. Wallace on the high cycle racetrack has already lost the lap because of a tire that went down. So he's running the higher groove, letting the faster cars to the inside.
Ricky Rudd, that red and white number 15 right there that Benny just told you about, has done well at this racetrack. This has been a good racetrack for the Floodboard team. They finished fourth and fifth a year ago, the same combination. And Flood cars have traditionally performed well here at North Wilkesboro. As a matter of fact, the last two Ford track wins here have been out of the racing stable of one Flood Moore.
As a matter of fact, I talked to Bud Moore this morning in the restaurant. Avid fans have been watching the last couple of telecasts. You know that Bud Moore missed the last two races. He is back and feeling fine. He's had a bout with hepatitis. But right now, look at Harry Gant going by Neil Bonnet as he come off turn two. And Tim Richmond coming right along with him.
That's in the sixth position for Harry Gant. Neil just out of the throttle here. And Tim Richmond has moved up alongside him. But remember, Tim is a lap down.
You know, while all this is going on, it makes great television. But you know what? That blue and yellow car, he's done this several times this year already. He's out there in front dominating again.
Of course, referring to Dale Earnhardt, who is the leader of the race, and there he is going into corner number one, right behind Chet Phillip and to the inside of J.D. McDuffie. So Dale Earnhardt is once again in the lead, and we talked to him earlier this weekend.
Well, everybody is real competitive, but our car's been consistently competitive about every racetrack we've been at. We're the leader in the hard cars award, which is points for leading laps, and we've led the most laps so far this
say that he has been competitive in every race this year would be somewhat of an understatement.
Last week at Charleston, South Carolina, if you were with us, you saw I was on the Speedway, but he led 335 or some number like that on 367 laps. It totally drove away from everyone there. And again, at North Wilkesboro, he's doing the same thing.
But I'll tell you, he's not dominating as much as we have seen this year because Joe Rutman in car number 26 is sneaking up on him as they now are on the main straightaway here. Joe is doing nicely and sneaking up on the rear end of Dale Earnhardt.
Most everybody who is competitive has finally, over the last two or three years, by osmosis almost, won at least one Winston Cup race. Without a doubt, Joe Rutman is the finest contemporary Winston Cup racer who has ever won. Could this be his day?
Sure good, the way he's coming right now. We can see there's the gap between he and Dale Earnhardt. That's Earnhardt in the yellow and blue machine. Joe Rutman in the green machine, about a half a straightaway. Just a few laps ago, it was a complete straightaway.
Yeah, it's 1.2 seconds, or it was last time around. We'll time it again this time to see if he has closed in even further. And it is just a little over 1 second interval between Dale Earnhardt and Joe Rutman.
If you are a regular watcher or follower of Grand National Racing, Winston Cup Racing, this goes without saying, but just as a reminder, we have a long ways to go. This race is about a quarter of the way, and the important thing is the ability to make that car perform. It's really the last half of that segment between pit stops, Benny, and we've got two or three more to go probably.
Oh, yeah, we certainly haven't decided anything so far, except that Earnhardt, again, is super competitive. But Joe Rutman, I'm impressed with the run so far. There we see Jeff Bodine, and what a terrible, terrible pit stop just a moment ago. He is back in eighth spot right now, and he was the clear leader just before the pit stop.
Not only was it a poor pit stop, but I don't think they were able to do exactly the quality work they were hoping for, because Benny, he has not been fast since he came out.
No, I noticed that the crew did not change the chassis. We saw them earlier on in Tim Richmond's pit stop reach in and change the chassis. I watched on Jeff Bodine's pit. They did not change the chassis. They were going to try to do, if they were making any adjustments, he was going to be with tires. So, and they may not have been able to get the tires on that they wanted since they did have a problem.
7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th here. Neil Bonnet in 7th, Jeff Bodine in 8th. Kyle Petty runs 9th in number 7, and Bill Elliott is 10th in number 9.
About Elliott, you know, he is having a very interesting day for him. It has been a struggle for that team this year. You know, at this time a year ago, he was well on his way to winning the $1 million bonus. We told you earlier, his only career short track finish in the lead lap was once here in 1983. It was a couple years ago. You see Kyle Petty darting down low to try and work on Jeff Bodine. The Elliott clan, I have the feeling that there's not frustration there, but disappointment without a question in terms of the results from this year. Everybody's talking about how well he's going to do at Talladega, but they're trying to get something accomplished here this week in North Louisville.
Kyle Petty trying to get underneath Jeff Bodine
going down in turn one, and he is alongside.
Ooh, they touch. And here comes the Bill Elliott car. He's going to try coming off turn two. Can he make it?
The number 5 car of Bodine, they are running with a great deal of confidence this year. They feel as though they've had a clear-cut shot every time to win, but a lot of little things have popped up. They do have that big win in the Daytona 500, the first race of this year, but, you know, they've got to start wondering about the performance of the car and what is going on and what's been occurring in the recent week. As Benny mentioned earlier, we saw some real strength from them before that almost aborted pit stop, and now Jeff is struggling to hold on. If he gets passed by Bill, he's got to worry about going a lap down to the leader, Earnhardt, that man right there.
And now Joe Rutman has caught Dale Earnhardt. He has slowly closed the gap, and now he is right on Earnhardt's back bumper. Let's see what Joe Rutman can do. He moves high on the racetrack in corner number 2, but Dale will hold on to the lead.
That was a strange line that Rutman took through turns 1 and 2. It was a little higher than you would expect him to be. That's maybe not so good trying to pass Dale Earnhardt, but it's great for traffic, as you see Kenny Schrader right in front of him. When they run across traffic, Joe Rutman, I think, is going to be the winner.
Benny, let me ask you a question. Put yourself inside of Joe Ruttman's mind as we look at the mind of Dale Earnhardt. Now, Joe Ruttman, you've never won a race before. There's a long ways to go in this race. It looks like, hey, I'm running just a little quicker than Dale right now. What do you do? Do you wait, or do you try and get by Dale right now and assert your superiority?
You want to get by Dale Earnhardt right now if you possibly can, because there's a lot of interested people in his pit area right now. Kenny Bernstein amongst them, that he would just love to take the lead just for them. One time past Dale Earnhardt and take the lead at a Winston Cup event. There's a spin down in turn one and two.
Tim Richmond is in the infield in turn number two, and this will bring out our second caution of the day. Tim pulls away after having gotten down in the infield there. But this brings out the caution, and we'll see what happens with the leaders. Will they come in for another pit stop?
Timmy has got to be laboring very, very hard. He got that very early race deficit, and I'm sure he's trying to make it up and talk about running right up to the competitive edge. I can assure you, knowing Timmy's personality and his real love of true racing, he is going for it, and maybe that contributed to that incident there.
Are fitting. Dale Earnhardt is on pit road, and so is Joe Ruttman. We watch the work on that machine.
And we see the fella in the left rear. He's changed the chassis. Just a very slight. That's the crew chief, Larry McReynolds. Just a slight change. So that means Joe Ruttman is pretty pleased with the car right now.
And they're changing all four tires on Dale Earnhardt's car. They now move to the driver's side, the left side of the car, and begin to change the rubber. We're under caution because of a spin by Tim Richmond, Darrell Waltrip. His work is completed in the pit area, and everybody now moving back onto the speedway.
And in some respects, those little changes, they're almost planned. You know you want to do something as the race wears on, because you watch the weather conditions, you try and monitor how slippery the track is getting, the inordinate amount of oil has been laid down, the rubber, whatever. So it's not a matter of those guys scrambling around and making a decision once the leader comes in or once your man comes in. You pretty much have a preconceived notion.
And here's a replay of Tim Richmond's problem.
What's happened? He tried to get underneath Mike Walter. He tried to cut underneath Walter, and it looked like maybe there wasn't enough room for there, and he spins the car. Jack Arute is down the pits with the 25 car. Jack?
Benny, they've elected to put all four new Goodyear tires on. They also attempted on the left rear screw jack, adding weight to the race car, so they're still taking the handle on this one.
That's the spot that they adjusted so dramatically the first time I saw him in the pits was the left rear of the car. So they're still adjusting on that one boat.
You know, Benny, so much has been written about Tim Richmond and his personality, which at best can easily be described as dynamic. But I really thought that when he stopped his car to congratulate his former crew chief, Barry Dodson, after his and Rusty Wallace's win at Bristol earlier this year, it revealed an awful kind and an awful interesting insight to one side of Tim Richmond's personality. I thought it was one of the wonderful issues so far in all the races.
Well, I think he's a pretty decent guy.
Let's try to talk with Tim again here before the green comes out, Benny.
Tim Richmond, this is Benny Parsons of the ESPN. What happened to the spin down there?
Mike Waltrip, I think, got his eyes closed. Well, he's trying to get by him, and he just cut down, and it was either spin it or take him and me out, so I spun it. We're just trying to hang on and finish this one now.
Good luck, man.
All right, the green comes back out now. As you can see, the baseball scores on our 2858 update. Hockey for you tonight here on ESPN. And, of course, all the highlights of the world of sports on SportsCenter later this afternoon.
As this race gets underway and we're monitoring all the scores, I'd like to make one comment about the fight last night after we watched the cars dip by. Larry Holmes, if you're listening or watching, it's a consensus in the elite NASCAR pit for this week. You won the fight last night, man. They took it from you.
There we see Richard Petty, some smoke coming out of the back of that Pontiac.
Pulling down.
Pulling over to the inside.
What a heartbreak for Richard Petty, who went into this race with great hopes. He had a tremendous early part of the weekend during qualifying, was on the pole for one day, but was knocked off of it because of the unique two-day average qualifying system that they have here in North Wilkesboro, and now he is really dropping off the pace.
And Benny, that kind of smoke doesn't look like just a gasket that's not been screwed down tight. That's the kind of smoke that more often than not is bordering on terminal.
Yes, that is the type of smoke that
like it is a problem that's not going away, that he's going to have to quit for the day. There we see Dale Earnhardt in the three car driving away again.
And second place now is Ricky Rudd. Third is Darrell Waltrip. And fourth is Joe Rutman. Running in fifth place is Bobby Allison. Then Harry Gant, Kyle Petty, Bill Elliott, and Neil Bonnet.
Just as we saw the first round of pit stops, Jeff Bodine had a terrible pit stop with him, leading back to about 10th spot. And again, Joe Rutman was running second right on Earnhardt's bumper, had a bad pit stop. He's back in the fourth spot. There's Richard Petty.
And Benny, it's obvious. Clearly evident from the sound of the motor that they've got a serious problem internally. Maybe they've dropped the valve. The motor is still running, as you can hear, but it doesn't have that crisp click, click of a Petty Enterprises Pontiac. Richard's staying in the car. Two misfires from the engine. He's consulting with Dale Inman and with Kurt Colwell, and now they've stalled it. Yes, Richard is coming out of the car. We'll get a word with him here as quick as we can.
So his next win will not come here at North Wilkesboro this afternoon. And a problem down in turn number two as a couple of cars are involved. Willie T. Ribbs is the stall car on the inside of the racetrack in turn number two. Also involved in the incident, we believe, would be Rick Baldwin in car number 64 and Buddy Arrington in 67. Ribbs, however, the only one that stopped down there. Now he begins to move away from the second turn and having a problem getting that car under control.
The right rear tire is completely gone on the automobile. He tried to take off, and there just wasn't a tire there. It's completely gone. He's on the rim of the car.
Here's a replay, Benny.
It looks like that he and the 64 car, Rick Baldwin, somehow got together. Baldwin, he spins. Baldwin comes down on the racetrack, and that's his...
Buddy Arrington also involved.
Buddy Arrington that runs into him. Tough break for Buddy because he was just a victim of circumstances.
And so our third caution of the afternoon. And I doubt if we see very many pit stops this time because of the fact that they were just in a few laps ago. Now, ESPN and NASCAR present a track fact.
NASCAR rules allow Winston Cup competitors to close in their opera windows, giving them an aerodynamic advantage when they run on super speedways. But here on short tracks, the windows come out so the crew chiefs can go in, and it's just the stacking and the handling on the car during pit stops.
This track fact has been brought to you by completed 137 laps of the first Union 400 at North Wilkesboro. Dale Earnhardt is the leader and will be right back. Back at North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina, where 143 of 400 laps have been completed in this Winston Cup race. The leader is Dale Earnhardt, but right behind him is Ricky Rudd, and right behind Rudd is Joe Rutman. Those are your first three. The problems continue for Rusty Wallace. He was in for a pit stop and lost a lap earlier, and just a few minutes ago, this is what happened as he was trying to get his lap back.
Trying to get that lap back desperately. He had ran a lap beside Dale Earnhardt, but there we see him get sideways down in turn one, and before he can get the car saved and get it under control, Tim Richmond just touches the left rear of the car, and away he goes.
And here's another angle of it.
Yeah, Bob Benny. Timmy didn't touch him, but it was one of those situations where Rusty was stopping right in front of Tim, and he had nowhere to go. Rusty went for it. It was the one car, one lap down, but just not quite enough to stick him, I guess, in it.
Now, the incident did not bring out the caution as Rusty was able to get the car going again. So we're still under green and a good race up front as the first three are running right together, nose to tail on the racetrack.
And there we see Tim Richmond in the 25 car. He's right behind Joe Rutman. He's two laps down. But if he can get up and get past Dale Earnhardt, get by all these cars, and the caution should come out, he could get one of those laps back.
Well, cars are on the lead lap. And Joe Rutman is running in third spot right behind Ricky Rudd in that number 15 car.
Dale Earnhardt was the most successful short track driver in NASCAR in 1985. He had an average finish, get this, a 5.6. He dropped out of one race. His average finish in the races that he finished was 2.8. So was he tough on the short track last year or not? He was really strong. Interestingly, Ricky Rudd, running second in the race right now, was the second, yes, the second most proficient runner on NASCAR's short tracks a year ago. He averaged 4.4 in all the races that he finished. And for your information, Harry Gant was the third best. Waltrip was fourth. And the fifth best was Lake Speed, interestingly enough.
and Elliott here racing side-by-side for eighth position. Rather for ninth and tenth, we should say. Neil Bonnet at number 12. Chevrolet and then the Ford of Bill Elliott.
There has been some great racing all around this racetrack today. You know, we take the camera to one spot, we have a great race, and all of a sudden we look around, there's another race going on. These fellows are really going after today.
And very few people have dropped out of this race. It is a typical North Wilkesboro race. Chet Phillips continues to race around this 5/8-mile racetrack. Jody Ridley remains out. Kenny Schrader, Bobby Hill Jr., Dave Marcus Hill, of course, running in the lead lap. Doug Everett is out there yet. J.D. McGuffey, Alan Kowicki.
And the battle for second place really heating up now. As a matter of fact, Joe Ruttman goes inside and takes second spot from Ricky Rudd.
And Tim Richmond right alongside Rudd trying to take that spot away. It's not for position.
Well, let's go down to Jack Arud, who has a closer eye on this Joe Ruttman situation.
Now, this Budweiser King special team, King Racing, is brand new this year. Came all together, picked up Joe Ruttman's driver. But remember, let's go back to the races so far. In Daytona, they didn't finish. In Richmond, they could have won their first race ever, but they crashed into the ensuing crash ahead of them. Then, we went on to Rockingham, and they crashed. We went to the Metro North track, they crashed. They're running this one now. You know what they're concerned about? That they can go the distance and not get into an altercation.
Well, he is certainly closing in on Dale Earnhardt. He's narrowed the gap to about four or five car lengths now, and that interval continues to shorten. Joe Ruttman, and one of his better performances of the year. Now we watch him come off the fourth corner, and it appears as if Ruttman is going to be able to make a challenge on the lead in just a couple of laps.
That car is fielded by Kenny Bernstein, the champion drag racer. Kenny has a habit of doing things extremely well when he gets involved in a project. He is probably one of the most organized teams. He's certainly one of the most well-publicized teams. He does a great deal of work in trying to keep up on it. And Joe Ruttman benefits really from that association.
Now Ruttman challenging for the lead. He goes high out of corner number two. Can't go into the lead. But certainly he makes Dale Earnhardt aware that he is there. And it's beginning, we understand, to rain here at North Wilkesboro as a few sprinkles have been felt in the pit area. It's a very windy day. The black clouds are rolling in and rain could be imminent. Ruttman would like to have the lead if we do have a rain interruption.
Ruttman needs to get by desperately because it just may rain. There is some dark clouds around and 200 left. If he can get to 200 left, it's a race. It's official. But and whoever's leading at that point is declared the winner.
And we've completed 157, so we're not really near the halfway point. Nevertheless, it is very important for Ruttman to be there in the lead if we do have a rain.
Go back to Richmond in 1982 when Joe Ruttman, the roles were reversed. He was leading that race as the rain came down. He broke a wheel just as it began to rain heavily. Moments after, he dropped out of the race, spun out of the race and crashed. The rain came. The race eventually was called, and Dave Marcus was awarded the victory. So Ruttman's got to be thinking about Richmond 1982.
It is a great race here in North Wilkesboro, the first Union 400. Earnhardt the leader, but Joe Ruttman is right behind him, and we'll continue with our live coverage. Wilkesboro, where 163 laps have been completed out of 400. That will make up the first Union 400. Right now, Dale Earnhardt continues to hang on to the lead, but he is hanging on for dear life, shall we say, as Joe Ruttman is still right there looking for the opportunity to pass. The leaders work through traffic. Really key rips in the white car number 30 to the inside and Michael Waltrip to the outside.
Boy, what a close call for Joe Ruttman. Wow. He squeezed between Willie Ritz and the Michael Waltrip car, just barely got through.
Well, I think that both Willie and Michael were in a tough spot. It was not a mistake by either one. They both tried to do their best job, and I think they pulled it off. Michael got stuck out there at no man's land up on the high side. Willie moved over down the low side like you're supposed to do, and boy, right there were Dale and Joe, and everybody got through on skate.
We understand it is sprinkling here, but it's not enough rain to bring out a caution and slow the cars down. But it's something we will certainly keep in mind. Now Ruttman going wide once again and high in the second corner.
It looks as though Ruttman has a faster race car, but You know, just like the tortoise in the hare, the fastest car does not always win. He has to get by Earnhardt. That's it. Earnhardt is the leader of the race. He can run any groove he wants to. Rutland has to get by. He just can't find the way to get by so far.
Let's see what happens as they work through traffic here once again. That was Alan Kulwicki that they passed there in the first corner to put another lap on Alan. Now they approach J.D. McDuffie, and they'll put a lap on him probably coming off of the fourth corner down the main straightaway. J.D. moving over to the inside, and both Earnhardt and Rutland passing.
Not only that, but Joe's job is really complicated by this weather. Rutland may have it this time. Let's see. No, not quite. But normally you have a lane and a half, maybe two lanes in certain places on the racetrack to get the job done. But with a wet racetrack, you're lucky to have one good lane.
All right, while we watch these guys go at it here, the next race that we'll televise for you here on ESPN will be in Talladega. Certainly a racetrack a lot different than North Wilkesboro, where you can see its contact is the password, really. But in Talladega, that's not the situation. As speeds are going to be well above 200, Benny, you'll be in that race. What do you anticipate as a qualifying speed?
Well, Bob, I tell you, I would not be surprised if the entire field, 40 cars in Talladega, does not qualify faster than 200 miles per hour. As far as what they're going to take to sit on the pole, my guess is somewhere around 211 miles.
You've been testing down there, or do you anticipate doing so?
We were down there testing in December. We ran around 205, but we felt like there was several more things we could do to run faster.
We've been watching at third and fourth, Ricky Rudd, Darrell Waltrip. There they are in the middle of your screen right now. Ricky Rudd in the Budmore Engineering Machine, the number 15. We told you how strong both of these guys were on short tracks in 1985. As a matter of fact, the last two or three years, this duo right here has been among the strongest competitors on tracks of 1 mile or less.
Third and fourth position, Ricky Rudd and Darrell Waltrip, driving for Junior Johnson.
These cars have drifted back from the first truth, from the front two. Dale Earnhardt and Joe Rubin putting a little distance on Rudd and Walter.
Joe Rutland, Larry McReynolds, Kenny Bernstein that we talked about earlier, they have really put together this program for this race. It's been an uphill struggle for them all year long. We've talked about the overall strength of Dale Earnhardt all year, so that's almost a given. You expect to see that. But nobody exactly expected to see Rutland this strong, this race long. Joe Rutland has really given this car a ride. I should say nobody really expected except you, Bob Jenkins. Monday of this week has said, I got a feeling about Rutland.
Well, I had a feeling about Rusty Wallace when he won Bristol, and for some reason, earlier last week, I just had the premonition that it was going to be a good race for Joe Rutland, and it has been so far.
I tell you what, there has been some communication between Joe Rutland and his crew, because I saw them down just a moment ago start scrambling around to try to put a set of tires together. So he has called in and told what he wants the next time they make a pit stop. The crew is getting those tires ready to put on the car.
Boy, the year of Dale Earnhardt has just been unbelievable to this point. He has led so many laps this season so far with only one victory. But, boy, you've got to be impressed with his performance. And we understand that the rain is coming down even harder now. And it may be just a matter of laps before we get a caution. These cars are slow from their high racing speed.
Joe Rutland, the man who started driving near his native Detroit, Michigan, and Toledo, Ohio in the 1970s. As a matter of fact, it was 1970 when he came out with an old Chevelle number 70, an electric yellow race car. He moved to Upland, California. He has run successfully in ASA. He's done a lot of late model racing up and down the West Coast. He went to USAC where he had a number of wins on dirt. He is one of the most experienced drivers in terms of road courses, dirt racing, high bank, paved oval, short tracks like this one. Rubin has enormous experience. He almost ended up, believe it or not, in an Indianapolis car. He had an almost ride in a Parnelli Jones open wheeler, and then he got directed down towards stock car racing here in the South. He is now here. Good.
178 laps completed, and Dale Earnhardt has led 96 of the 178. It's pretty obvious, guys, that Tim Richmond has found the problem that he had experienced, because he's staying right up there with Rutland and Earnhardt.
Well, we saw this on their pit stop twice. We have witnessed his crew going inside the car and making those casting adjustments. And maybe that's all he needed, Bob. Just some more wedge or bite in the car when he started the race.
Earnhardt is continuing to door. We're presenting live coverage of the First Union 400. Unbelievable action here on the 5-8 at North Wilkesboro as Joe Ruttman is trying desperately to get around Dale Earnhardt. They work through heavy traffic now. Chet Phillips is the car they're lapping. Now, a lap ago, here is what happened as Joe Ruttman worked inside of Dale Earnhardt in corner number four.
This is the start-finish line, but on the outside, Earnhardt had the initiative going for the momentum. He was able to pass Ruttman. Here again, coming off turn four, Joe looks inside one more time.
Update in the lap, 186 this time by. 15 more laps, and we have an official race if the sky falls down. So Joe Ruttman has got to be watching that rear deck lid of Dale Earnhardt. He's also got to be watching the skies and the size of those raindrops in the front windshield.
And he's also watching the rearview mirror because Tim Richmond is right behind it. And just that last time we saw the pass, the near pass going down in turn one, Richmond dove under Joe Ruttman and they almost collided as they exit turn two.
Now remember, Tim Richmond is two laps down, so is not here challenging for the position, but he certainly is giving Joe Ruttman some problems.
There is some traffic right in front of Earnhardt and Ruttman, and there is rain on the racetrack. So Joe Ruttman, if he's going to get by, he's got to do it in the next
lap. Oh, it's Darrell Waltrip spinning in turn number two. Waltrip losing it right in front of Ricky Rudd, with whom he was battling for position. And Waltrip will bring out the caution flag with 188 laps down.
And Earnhardt wins the race. The race to the flag. If it should start raining and we complete 200 laps, Dale Earnhardt is going to win the race.
It might have just ended right there. We've got an outside chance that move, that last turn coming off of turn number four, might have been the difference.
And here's the spin as Waltrip lost it right ahead of Ricky Rudd and Bobby Allison.
I didn't see any contact. There may have been. I did not see any contact whatsoever between Rudd and the 11 car. Looks like Darrell just got in the corner and possibly the racetrack a little bit damp, lost control and spun around. Darrell did not lose the lap.
Right.
He was able to get the car under control and continue on. He is in the lead lap.
That is correct. However, Jeff Bodine and Neil Bonnet and others are making scheduled pit stops once again.
But it's really an unexpected factor that works into the formula of attempting to win a race on the Winston Cup Trail. You know, if this were open wheel, particularly IndyCar or Formula One type racing, everybody ducks in the pits and you put on rain tires. But you don't do that, of course, in Winston Cup racing. The Winston Cup cars can go longer because of their extra weight than the open wheel cars under wet conditions. But how far can you go and still be safe?
And, of course, Larry has been on the Formula One circuit so far this year and will be back with another Formula One race next Sunday from Imola. We'll be right back at North Wilkesboro. It'll be a great hockey game tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern Time. Join us here on ESPN, and we hope you'll stay with us for this Winston Cup race at North Wilkesboro, where Dale Earnhardt continues to lead. Now he has Tim Richmond between himself and second place Joe Ruttman. And just a couple of laps ago, Jeff Bodine almost lost it in corner number four.
Yes, he did. Looks like that he and right in front of him, the red and blue car, Buddy Anderson. Buddy pointed to Harold Kendall, the flagman, pointing to the sky. Hey, Harold, there's some moisture around here.
We are past the halfway mark. We will be in two more laps. In fact, this is lap number 198. So we'll have two more to go, and then we will have an official race halfway in this 400 lapper.
I tell you what, Dale Earnhardt has never been more glad to see anything in his life than he is looking in his rearview mirror and seeing Tim Richmond, because that means that fella can't beat him, but Joe Ruttman can.
Let me ask you, you know, Harold Kinder is kind of like suggesting the move over flags for Richmond, and he's staying there. What is common courtesy in this situation? Richmond getting out of shape going into one and two, but what is common courtesy? Stay there and try and get your lap back. You're down two, not one, or do you move over and let Joe go by?
Well, I really think that with the skies the way they are, with the threat of rain, that he probably ought to move over and let Joe Ruttman try to win the race. Because it is official race right now. They just have completed halfway. It's official. But if it shouldn't rain, Richmond needs to be in the right spot. It's his decision to make. He's making a decision to try to fight Dale Earnhardt.
All right, let's go down to Jack Arruda in the pit area. Jack, you're down in the elements there. We're up here in the air-conditioned booth. What is the weather like down there? Is the racetrack slick? Is it raining that hard?
Yes, indeed, it is raining quite hard. Please watch the cars down here. In turn number one, they tend to
Joe. Is it still windy down there, Dalto?
I couldn't hear you, Bob. Try again.
Is it still very windy down there?
Well, actually, the wind has died down a tad. But what's happened is the temperature has gone down as much as 15 degrees since we went on the air. And the water is wet.
That's usually the way water is. On your screen, remember, though, that in Richmond, there, the red car is a lap down as we see the NBA scores this afternoon. And the rest of the sports news that we'll update you on SportsCenter a little bit later this afternoon. And, of course, we have tennis coming up right after this race.
Well, with the caution flags that we've had, 12 cars have remained on the lead lap. We've documented the first four a couple of times. Allison's still up there running in the top five. Bodine, around six or seven. Other cars in the lead lap remain Harry Gant, Neil Bonnet, Bill Elliott, Kyle Petty, Jerry Labonte, not being able to get any higher than seventh or eighth, and young Bobby Hillen Jr. Benny, he's doing it again. I think this young man has come on and got a real future in this type of race.
He certainly does. I was talking to his owners, Mickey and Bill Stavola, Thursday night, and I tell you, they are very, very pleased with the progress that Bobby Hillen has made so far. And there we see Bobby Allison and Jeff Bodine. That's for fourth spot. Jeff Bodine back up to fourth spot.
Jeff, of course, the pole sitter for this race, but has not led very many laps, really. He is trying to work his way back up into the lead. He is now in fourth, and Bobby Allison runs fifth.
I'll tell you something about Bodine. I got a lot of confidence in Gary Nelson. Maybe something personal, but a lot of professional confidence, too, in Gary Nelson. Jeff looks like he's running a little quicker, Benny, than he has the last 25 or 30 green laps. He is moving up on Ricky Rupp. That's third. He's not that far behind Earnhardt and Ruttman. I think he's suddenly becoming a part of this picture again.
I think he is, too. As a matter of fact, I think he has found some of the handle that he has lost, because I don't know if he lost the handle as much as he did get behind all that traffic and that bad pit stop that he had. The very first pit stop that he made was just terrible.
And Rutland has snuck around Richmond. So Joe Rutland now has no longer a competitive front-running type car between himself and the leader, and the yellow flag is out.
And it is going to come out because of rain. The racetrack has become, in the NASCAR official's opinion, too slick to race on. 209 laps have been completed. We are past the halfway point. If we should get a rain out, it will be an official race. Dale Earnhardt is the leader, Joe Rutman second, Ricky Rudd third, Jeff Bodine fourth, and Bobby Allison fifth.
The question mark is, who pits and who doesn't pit?
Exactly.
If you pit and the race should rain out, then you go all the way back to 12th. Or how many cars? 12 cars in the lead lap. You go all the way back to 12th. But if you decide to stay out there, the race does resume. They throw the green flag. You're sitting out there with worn-out tires.
Very reminiscent of the race that we televised in Richmond several years ago, in which everybody pitted. Dave Marcus stayed out, and he won the race. We'll be back with more at rainy North Wilkesboro. Well, we hope it stops, because it has interrupted our first Union 400 here at North Wilkesboro. With 212 laps completed, the field is slowed behind the pace car because of rain. Earnhardt, Rutman, Rudd, Bodine, and Allison are your top five. And the umbrellas have come out in the grandstand and in the pit area. Speaking of the grandstand, we told you that this place seats about 18,000 people. The estimated attendance here today, 29,500. It's a record crowd. And so the people here in North Wilkesboro have to be very pleased with the turnout.
I'm sure they are. The rest of the people are in the infield. The infield is just packed. And there also is a tremendous amount of campers down in turns one and two. That we can see some of the crowd. That's the front straightaway you're seeing right now on the screen. And as you can see, there's no empty seats there.
And they're not really going for their cars. It is raining, but it's not a real steady downpour. So hopefully we can get this race resumed before too much longer. Jack Arute is unfortunately out in the rain, and he's with Richard Childress,
who is also out in the rain and in a bit of a quandary right now. Richard, do you bring in Dale Earnhardt, or do you leave him out in hopes that this thing goes to red and is called a complete race?
Well, I figure that we'll come back and race some more, but we just want to try to keep the track position right now. It's too slick to be racing on right now, and Dale says he just can't see out of the windshield like this.
impression, at least as a crew chief, of how the racetrack is holding up and how you guys are able to chase the handle and find the right setup. These tires are very hard, but they don't seem to concern your team as much as somebody else.
Well, we worked on it yesterday evening pretty hard. If you noticed, we started out a little slow. The car was coming around, so now I don't know what's going to happen in this rain. It's just anybody's race.
Well, we're just going to have to wait and see. Down here in the children's pit, they're going to do likewise. At least Dale Earnhardt's out, at least for the time being.
All right. While we're under this yellow, we will establish some radio communication here with Tim Richmond and find out how things are going for him. Tim Richmond, this is Benny Parsons up in the ESPN control. Do you read me?
Yeah, Benny, go ahead.
Tim, how bad was the rain just a few laps ago?
Well, as far as racetrack conditions were concerned, it was not as good. It was getting to be a little bit dangerous. It wasn't a point to where we couldn't drive them at all, but the biggest factor was we couldn't see out of the windshield. Had there been a problem in front of any of the drivers, it would have taken a little bit to see through the mist that's on the windshield right now. So the biggest problem, looking out through the glass instead of what's on the racetrack.
Well, Tim, you were able to race with Dale Earnhardt and Joe Ruttman. The cars are running 1-2 right now. Your opinion, who's the strongest of the two?
Right now, they're pretty much equal, but the strongest man's the one that's out front because this track's so treacherous anyway. As far as the forward bike, you get off the corner. If you're in front, you can hold the if you're two equal cars, you can hold whoever's behind you off and not have to worry about it. So it's whoever gets to jump on the start and gets in the lead will be the strongest car if they both continue to have the same handling characteristics that they have been having.
Well, Tim, your car earlier on was terrible. When you started the race, you drifted back. But right now, you seem to be one of the faster cars on the racetrack. What have you done to the automobile?
Benny, we've just came in and made some adjustments to the chassis. We've tightened it up considerably, but it's still not. I can't imagine what has happened from the last practice yesterday. We had an absolute, what I felt and everybody else had, a perfect car. And then when we started the race today, it was not even close. So I don't know. The track changed or something has changed. I don't know. It's just a mystery why we couldn't run as good as we did practice yesterday. We'd still be on the same lap, I'm sure, if that had happened.
Well, Tim, I was handed a note by Bob Jenkins, our co-anchor up in the booth up here, and the note says, ask him about getting married. What about it? Are you going to get married?
Well, I don't know. That's up to the person that I've asked. Benny, we won't know until the time comes. We could get a yay, we could get an A. We'll just have to wait and see. Right now, there's no plans over there. This has been the big question, man.
But you have asked if a lady to marry you. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is correct. We're waiting on the answer. You never know. It might come tomorrow, a good answer. And you never know. It might come 20 years from now. We never know.
Or it may never come. Thanks, Tim. Good luck.
Roger. Thank you.
So one of the world's most eligible bachelors may be tying the knot here before long. Tim Richmond, car number 25. Still on the racetrack, although he has spun once, but is still out there, competitive, is Willie T. Ribb in the Red Roof Inn car. Willie has become the third black race driver to make a Winston Cup race, and earlier Larry Newberg had a chance to sit down and talk with him.
Willie T. Ribb has made a Winston Cup stock car race. Willie, your first reaction?
Well, you know, we knew it was going to be tough coming in. You know, I started late in the season. We didn't sign till January, and we went looking around for support and getting cars properly done. And, you know, Jim Truman, you know, who's been my mentor for the last 5 years, stepped up with his Red Roof Inn Motel support, and we put the team together, you know, and things are coming along. We got a lot of work to do. I got to get a lot more practice. You know, this weekend is the first time I've ever driven this car. So, you know, that was an accomplishment to step in a car I'd never driven before and get it around here.
has too much been written and said about your quest? I mean, you are, after all, a race driver just trying to make the grade in a tough league. Has there been too much press?
Well, you know, I don't know. A lot of people, you know, throughout my whole career, Formula Fords in Europe, Trans Am, Formula Atlantic, there's always been something made of it, you know. And then once I started winning, you know, it got even bigger. Well, now I've come a winner from Trans Am into NASCAR. So, you know, it's not like I came out of nowhere and no one knew me. People know me, and they expect a lot out of me like I do out of myself. And coming into NASCAR with the drivers, Richard Petty, who they call the King, Jaws, who they call Waltrip.
Who's been a big help to you, by the way.
Yeah, I mean, Darrell Waltrip and Neil Bonnet, Bobby Allison, really gone out of their way. You know, Benny Parsons really try to make the transition as easy because they went through it, you know. And it's tough. These cars are heavy. They're tough to drive. And, you know, they look easy, but they're a lot of work.
Willie T. Ribbs from San Jose, California.
And, you know, at the beginning of this, you mentioned three black drivers. I think that everyone that follows Winston Cup racing knows about Wendell Scott. But there was a young man in 1975 that did run a Winston Cup event, Randy Bethay. A boy from Asheville, North Carolina. He grew up in Asheville, and when he was grown, he moved to Newport, Tennessee, and started running Grand National or Late Model Sportsman, it was called then. And looked like he had a promising career, and he went on overwheel racing for some reason and did not have the success that in his sportsman cars. But Randy Bethay was a black young man who did run a Winston Cup event in the middle seven.
And Willie T. is the third. The situation here in North Wilkesboro is we are under a rain hesitation with Dale Earnhardt the leader, and we'll be right back. We are back at North Wilkesboro where the rain continues to come down, but we understand we will go back to green in about two more laps. The leader is Dale Earnhardt, or was at the halfway point. He had led 118 laps and had about a half second lead over Joe Ruttman. An hour, 16 minutes and 4 seconds, the time of the race to the halfway point, and there had been four leaders. Average speed, 97.627 miles an hour. There had been four caution periods for a total of 14 laps. 12 cars were on the lead lap, and a total of 28 cars were on the racetrack. Out of race officially, Trevor Boys in car number 6, and Richard Petty, who started outside of row number 1, also has retired from competition. Now, we have had a little bit of pit strategy here because of the fact that we are going back to green. Joe Ruttman has come in for a pit stop. Bobby Allison has come in for a stop. And so this kind of changes the strategy that we'll see in the remaining laps. In addition to that, Darrell Waltrip has also been in for a pit stop, and so has Terry Labonte. We should be back to green in just a moment. Join us for the restart. The first Union 400 Winston Cup race here in North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, being brought to you by Mr. Goodrich. No one knows your GM car better than Mr. Goodrich. By Dickies, they're America's favorite work clothes, but who says you have to work in them? And by Quaker State, the big Q stands for quality, always has, always will. Harold Kinder is signaling the field one more lap, and then we're going to go back to green. And we understand that it is still sprinkling down in the pit area, but apparently the NASCAR officials have determined that the track is safe for high speeds. Until next time, we'll get the green.
Something very interesting this time, because Dale Earnhardt, Jeff Bodine, Neil Bonnet, Bobby Hill, and the first four cars on the lead lap chose not to pit. Not to pit on the caution flag. The first car on the racetrack that has new tires, Darrell Walker, Carl Evans.
Boy, they're doing a lot of bumping and shoving around it. They're trying to get position. They're supposed to start two abreast. The car's in the lead lap on the outside. Here comes Earnhardt without having stopped.
Green comes back out. The first Union 400 resumes here in North Wilkesboro. Some of the leaders have been it. Some have not. Dale Earnhardt has not. He's in the lead right now, being chased down the backstretch by Jeff Bodine. And here comes Neil Bonnet in car number 12 into third.
Now, just a note about the window. Probably can go 160 laps on this track under green flag conditions on a full load of fuel. 160 laps. We have 170 left to go. So it seems unlikely that everybody who's just hit it should go the distance. But how far can Earnhardt go? He's gone about 100 laps since he stopped.
Tight racing. Bodine just shoves Earnhardt out of the way, and Jeff Bodine comes into the lead.
He takes the lead just for the caution flag for the rain. Jeff Bodine, as you said, one of the faster cars on the racetrack. Right now, he's beginning to assert that speed.
That was an unbelievable pass that Jeff Bodine made going into the third corner. This is what happened. Benny, you can explain it.
Well, Jeff Bodine gets under Earnhardt in turn three and just moves. We're going in turn three. I'm sorry. This is down the back right away. They go into turn three. Bodine just goes up because Earnhardt is by his spot, and he'll have no choice to move over, let him go.
And now he's beginning to stretch out the advantage on Dale Earnhardt. He's opened up quite a bit of a lead here. Meanwhile, Earnhardt back in second is being challenged by Neil Bonnet, who's right on Earnhardt's tail and sneaking up on the top three, Darrell Waltrip, the other Junior Johnson car.
Now, this is a brief rundown. Earnhardt stopped at lap 125. We're now at lap 234. So that was 110 laps to go or so that he stopped, so he can go a little ways yet, but certainly not the distance. Bodine stopped at lap 189. Remember, again, we're at lap 234, as did Bonnet at lap 189.
Of the three cars that we're seeing on the screen right now, Darrell Waltrip, as I mentioned, the only car with four fresh tires, and it ought to give Darrell a tremendous advantage. Right now, he doesn't seem to be utilizing the advantage, but he ought to have one.
Boy, Bodine has really taken off, guys. I tell you, Bodine has a football field already, the proverbial football field, over Earnhardt, Bonnet, and Waltrip. And Bonnet and Waltrip look like they're trying to get by Dale.
Yeah, Neil looked to the inside there down the backstretch. Now it looks like he may have moved up and bumped Dale very briefly. In corner number three, they come down the straightaway and continue to run in the same order. There is the interval between Jeff Bodine, the leader, and second, third, and fourth position. It is a healthy lead that Bodine has opened up here as we went back to green.
I think that the 12 car, Neil Bonnet, and certainly the 11 car of Darrell Waltrip could probably run with the 5 of Jeff Bodine if they could only get by Dale Earnhardt. And that's not the easiest job in the world. We've watched Joe Rutherford lap after lap. He couldn't do it, and Jeff Bodine had to use muscle to do it.
Well, you begin to see some of that experience assert itself from the Junior Johnson camp. Look who's up there in the front. Now, here's Joe Ruttman. Joe Ruttman is trying to struggle to get through the field. He's about in seventh position right now, being very careful and cautious to work his way through. He's passed about 10 cars, two or three of them on the same lap. Ruttman running quicker, seemingly, than everybody around him, but he hasn't been able to move up to the front to get into the top five and challenge.
He's actually eighth, Larry, and working on Harry Gant, who is running in seventh position. As behind Gant and Ruttman, we have some action involving Bobby Allison and Ricky Rudd and Bobby Dillon Jr. and others. They go in there three wide.
And there's Kyle Petty in number seven, Tim Richmond in number 25. Great, great race. There's Petty trying to get underneath Hillen coming off turn four down the back straightaway.
Benny, let me exclaim about Bobby Hillen Jr. He's only 21 years of age. This is a very young man and really a mature man sport. And Bobby Hillen has begun to come near the top often in 1986. I think that man right there, the number eight car, is destined for an awful fine NASCAR Winston Cup career.
Certainly looks like it. There we see the 7 car, Kyle Petty, trying to get alongside Doug Hebron in 17. And Tim Richmond right back just waiting for Kyle to make a slip so he can get by. Now Richmond's going right on the inside. He's alongside as they come off turn two.
Tim Richmond is 2 laps in arrears to the leader, Jeff Bodine, who, believe us, is just really going to town on the field. Hebron is showing as 5 laps down in this battle, but they're all running for relative position on the racetrack. Kyle Petty, again, in that group, is the only car that is on the lead lap.
There is Kyle Petty going inside of Doug Hebron in the number 17 car. That's the HESCO exhaust system Oldsmobile. And he passes Hebron, and now here comes Tim Richmond in the same groove on the inside of the racetrack.
Well, we can see just how much an advantage the inside groove is on the racetrack. Hebron was able to stay in front of those 2 cars until they got on the bottom of the racetrack, and they just simply drove right by.
Kyle Petty in 12th position.
by the way, talking about that number 17 car, we've seen last year's pole setter at Indianapolis, Pancho Carter, surface in this type of racing. He will be in that 17 car the next Super Speedway race. He's been running the 64 car. He will move over to Roger Hanvey's 17 car, at least temporarily.
While Jeff Bodine leads, here is second place Dale Earnhardt, third place Neil Bonnet, and fourth Darrell Waltrip.
Earnhardt putting a car mixer to all Neil Bonnet. Looks like Bonnet is losing just a little bit of the handle right now. Earnhardt able to put a couple of car mixers on. And I hear this from the reports around the racetrack, the rain is starting again. Darrell Walters, with those fresh tires, he just can't get by.
This car, of course, has a very tight handle on the situation regarding whether they have their own radar. And their report is that we do have a front moving in, and ahead of the front are these scattered showers that could plague us all afternoon long. But if they don't amount to any more than the first one did, I don't think it's going to cause our race to end prematurely. That one shower we did have did wet the track, and we ran under caution for a while, but now we're back to green, and we hope, of course, we don't have any more rain, but if we do have rain, let's hope it's just these scattered light showers. We'll be back with more of the First Union. The Flames and the Oilers tonight at 8 o'clock here on ESPN. Here at North Wilkesboro, we are under caution again because of a spin in turn number two involving Willie T. Ribbs. Now, the most important thing that has come out of this little spin over in turn number two is that Neil Bonnet in car number 12, who is running there right behind the leader of the race, Ricky Rudd, has lost a lap. Jack Arut can perhaps update us on what happened.
Well, here's the confusion, Benny, Bob, Larry. I was down here at the end of pit road, could not see the pit stop, heard you people alluding to it, but when the number 12 car pulled back out on the racetrack, he had the green go sign. So they didn't hold him to keep him down that lap. So I'm going to check on that, but what I wanted to do was fill you in on the strategies down here with the leader. Earnhardt took on four new tires and fuel. He can now go the distance. He doesn't need to stop again. Likewise for Tim Richmond. Likewise for Jeff Bodine, who also came in. Further up the back of the pack, the 26 car Joe Ruttman also came in to put on new shoes. So it looks like we're going to have one whale of a finish. Mother Nature will just cooperate.
Let's hope she does. Here comes the green flag out once again. And, Benny, there is no doubt that Neil Bonnet did lose a lap on that.
Yes, he did, because I watched him come in, and I said, you know, I said to him one here in the booth, he pitted too quickly. And sure enough, we watched. As a matter of fact, Buddy Aaron was the car that did, in fact, put him a lap down.
So Ricky Rudd is the leader now, and a lot of traffic behind Ricky in turn number four. Joe Ruttman is second. He's being literally pushed out there by Dale Earnhardt, who is third. Then Darrell Waltrip, then Jeff Bodine, and Terry Labonte in car number 44 is smoking and falling off the pace. A tough break for the Corpus Christi driver.
Yes, the Oldsmobile driver.
Ruttman is spinning. He got touched by Earnhardt. In turn four, Joe Ruttman has made a complete 360. He was really off the pace. I shouldn't use the word really, but he was not running as quickly as the other front runners and Dale Earnhardt, and he touched as they moved through turns three and four, and Ruttman goes around one time, keeps the engine fired.
Can you imagine that all those cars missed him?
Yeah, that was a miracle.
It was a miracle.
They really scrambled, but everybody did. And Terry Labonte has pulled into the pits, and it looks like it's over for him. Ruttman has resumed and is catching up with the rest of the field.
There we see J.D. McDuffie on the inside of the racetrack, going down the front straightaway. But if we can get a camera to go right in behind the 44 car, we can see what happened to his automobile, because we see the trail of oil running right to the engine on the car 44.
Well, let's go to Jack Arut, who is with Terry.
Well, Terry is finally getting all of the paraphernalia off his body here. The helmet goes out. Terry, what put you out of the race? Blown motor?
Yeah, I don't know what happened to it. Some broken motor.
Taking a look at the way people have been cramming at it all afternoon here, who do you think has got the best advantage? Who do you think out there really has got the key to victory right now?
I don't know. It's definitely like it's up here. Bodine's running awful strong. Of course, Earnhardt's running good.
Now, Mother Nature hasn't been cooperating. These intermittent sprinkles, they haven't been much help to a race driver out there either.
Well, the racetrack's been awful wet at times, and a lot of those laps should have been run under the caution, but so that might play a part in the finish.
Well, it's going to be one way to finish, one way to the other.
All right, J.D. McDuffie's car is being taken off of the racetrack.
Now, the reason for this caution originally was an incident up in turn number three involving Ruttman, Earnhardt, and others.
Let me speculate. Now, Ruttman's in the green car. You see, he's been touched by Dale Earnhardt. We mentioned that he was off the pace. And Benny, even though he spun in this, I think this played into his hand because this may have been a long green flag segment had he not had that problem, which brought out the yellow flag. The setup was so far gone, this gives him an advantage, an opportunity to change that bad setup, maybe get back to a better one.
Well, I'm not sure. I think that Joe Ruttman did not change tires just a moment ago. The preceding pit stop, and therefore may have, you know, not had his tires as good as anyone else. Jackaroo, maybe you can update us from the pits.
I can update you on the condition of car 12, Neil Bonnet, going a lap down. Tim Brewer is here with me. Tim, what was the situation? How did you move that lap?
Caution flag came out, Jackie. We anticipated everybody else coming down pit road. You know, I told Bonnet to pit. You know, we came in. They ran wide open around the racetrack. We sat here and lost a lap sitting on the jack. We thought we could beat them out, but we anticipated everybody else stopping, too. So, you know, I guess it was just, you know, one of those big misdirected calls there.
Just a gamble on your part, trying to get in and out quick and not have to work your way back up through traffic?
Well, we anticipated, you know, the other leaders coming in, too, you know, and I'd already made the call to come in and slow down. He went ahead and took the caution on the racetrack. So he run wide open around the racetrack, put us a lap down. You know, not that bad of a deal, you know. We've got fresh tires sitting on the inside road. You know, get the caution flag, we'll get it back. We can still race.
Benny, there's a lot of times that drivers have a headache on Monday morning for the miscues they've had, but crew chiefs get them too.
Yeah, you could. Tim Brewer admitted he made a mistake. He pitted too soon. He should have told her. Neil Bonnet, which is what Leo Jackson, my crew chief, tells me, he says, pit with the leaders. That's the terminology that Leo said. If the leaders pit, then you pit. If they stay on the racetrack, you have to stay on the racetrack with them.
You pretty much just watch what happens up in front of you and do what they do.
That's correct. If you are the leader, then you have to make the decision on whether or not you're going to pit or not. I tell you what, there's a lot of people leaving right now, so there must be some rain. Jackie, is it raining pretty good down there right now?
Oh, yeah, indeed. It's coming down harder than it has been all day. And you know what's ironic is this area of the country has been asking for rain, for the last month or 2 months, but they didn't want it this afternoon in North Wilkesboro.
Well, you can say that again, but unfortunately, that is the situation. It looks like it's raining pretty hard now, and it looks like the track may be getting slick once again. We'll be back with more from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. North Wilkesboro, where it is continuing to rain, and we are under caution because of that. Let's hope that the Boston money this year, $250,000 at stake. Well, guys, it is raining, and it doesn't look real good. Ricky Rudd right now is the leader of the race behind the pace car, and Jeff Bodine is second, and I think there's a real question at this point as to whether we ever will go back to green.
I think you're exactly right, because the racetrack is getting darker and darker, which means it's getting wetter and wetter. The people in the stands that put some plastic over their bodies, they're trying to protect themselves from the rain. Doesn't look good right now.
It has been a rather bad day for Rusty Wallace, and we'll try to raise him on the radio and see how his spirits are.
Rusty, this is Larry Newber up at ESPN. This has been truly a day of survival for you guys, hasn't it? Rusty, are you getting a reading on us? No. Well, we'll try it one more time. Rusty, a reading from ESPN, anything? I have a feeling that he's hearing us, but we're not getting him back. So, Rusty, thanks for the offer, and hang in there. I'll tell you, it has been a long day for you guys, but hang in there, Rusty.
Yes, radio isn't even working properly, apparently. Now, Harold Kinder is directing the field down low on the racetrack to kind of run in that area to help dry the track out. And you can see that it is getting darker and wetter down there.
Let's go back to this streak. 11 different races, 11 different winners, the last 11 going over to last year. Remember that Ricky Rudd won the final race of 1985, so he is in the middle of that streak. He would break that can, but he has not won yet in 1986. So should Ricky go on to win this race, we would now have 7 races in 1986 and 7 different winners. So a streak of another sort, Benny and Bob, would continue.
And not only that, but I think one of the most important things about a Rudd win today would be Ford winning again and winning legitimately. And I'm not indicating that Kyle's win was not a legitimate one, but he did pretty much back into the win, so to speak.
Well, in Richmond, Virginia, Kyle Petty was running fifth with three laps to go when the first four cars crashed. Dale Earnhardt, Darrell Walker, Joe Rutland, and Jeff Bodine all crashed. Darrell Cruz on in there, won the automobile race. You folks just a moment ago saw the Ricky Rudd Ford, the Motorcraft Ford, go down the pit road, and it looked like a big hole in the front. Folks, there was a big hole in the front. The grill is gone in the automobile. I guess he has hit someone, broken the grill. NASCAR has told them that they have to get there. We can see the nose of the car. The grill completely gone. He's hit someone and knocked the grill. NASCAR made him take the grill out because the pieces may fall on the racetrack and cause someone to have a flat tire. And that's not good, because if someone should throw up a little bit of debris, there normally is some screen in front of that grill to stop the debris. He has nothing except the radiator back there. And just the sleep, the light, the least little thing can put a hole in the radiator.
So we're still slowed under caution, and we have completed 270 laps. We have 130 to go, but the question is, will we go back to green? We hope so. Come back in just a moment. With Benny Parsons, Larry Neuber, Jack Arute, this is Bob Jenkins at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina Speedway for the First Union 400. We are under caution because of yellow. However, drivers have been told by Harold Kinder they will go green in four more laps. Let's try to establish radio contact with Rusty Wallace once again.
Rusty, this is ESPN again. We're going to give it one more shot in this radio. You've got a reading on it this time, Rusty. Well, for your information, Rusty, we did have you during the break. We were able to monitor something, but once again, it's gone out. Again, we know it's been a tough day, and we sure thank you for trying, my man, and hanging there.
Right ahead of Rusty on the racetrack is Tim Richmond, and we have been successful in our conversations with Richmond earlier in the race.
Tim Richmond, Benny Parsons up in ESPN. Do you read us?
Talking to us.
Tim, this is Benny Parsons. Do you read me?
Yeah, Benny, go ahead.
Well, NASCAR says you're going to go back racing in about three laps. The racetrack okay?
Yeah, Benny, the track seems to be not holding the rain at all. As much as it's rained, I would figure some places have been wet enough to where you probably couldn't race. This place don't seem to be holding. It seems to be evaporating once it gets down to the track. So it will be okay. It'll be a whole lot better if I get just one of these two laps I'm down on the restart.
135 laps to go. Can you go the rest of the way, or are you planning on going the rest of the way?
Yeah, if it goes green all the way through, Benny, we will try to go, unless we obviously run out of fuel. But right now, we think we can go. But our main concern right now is that we're two laps down. To try to get at least one back now, and if there's another caution, work ourselves back to where we can be on the same lap. And hopefully, at the end of this race, at least have a shot for the win.
How is your tire situation now, Tim? Is your tires as good as Ricky Rudd's, the leader's?
Right now, Benny, I think I've got one of the two best sets I've had on today. And I definitely think the way Ricky's been running earlier, we will be able to go up there and at least challenge him. But passing here is a different story, because you can't use up the tires or you'll just go backwards.
On the tire situation, Tim, which tires are better? Brand new tires, tires that have a few laps on them, which is better?
Well, right now, Benny, probably brand new tires. My car seems to start working better than other cars about 20 laps into a tank of fuel. So that's basically how we got the car set up too, but not only that, but the tires. But I think it's advantageous to start on brand new sticker tires rather than scuffed right now.
Tim, appreciate it. Good luck.
Thank you, Benny.
So Rutman has been into the pit area and is back out there. Now we go down to the pit area, and Jack, who has more on this grill situation with Ricky Rudd's car.
Can I interest any of you in a grill for a Ford Thunderbird 1986 model, only driven on Sunday? Here it is, right here. They pulled it off the car. Ricky Rudd's radiator is now totally exposed. There isn't anything like this keeping rocks and debris from penetrating the radiator. So it's going to be a very thick as you can through the tiptoe through the tulip, so to speak, for Ricky Rudd the rest of the day.
And he will start his tiptoeing in a half more lap because the field is lining up two abreast for the restart. We are about to go back to green.
10 cars on the lead lap unofficially in order. Rudd, Bodine, Earnhardt, Bill Elliott, Allison, 5th, Gann, 6th, Walton, 7th, despite a spin.
Hillen, 8th. Kyle Petty, 9th. Joe Ruttman, 10th. One lap down, 12 Bonnet, 27 Wallace. Two laps down, 25 Richmond.
Pace car off the track. The crowd anticipates a restart, and they get it. We're back to racing.
Ricky Rudd got a great jump, was able to get by Neil Bonnet and try to keep him that lap back. And also Tim Richmond. And Tim got it sideways coming off turn two. He got Bodine, pulls on the outside.
Tim was sideways going down the back stretch, but saved him. Here they come off the fourth corner. Ricky Rudd is leading. Jeff Bodine is in second position. Between the leader in second place is Neil Bonnet, who's trying to get his lap back. To the inside, couldn't get it. Now here comes Bodine outside of Neil Bonnet. And Bonnet, you can see smoke in the tires on the inside. The left side rubber is smoking there in the fourth turn. And Bodine now really making a serious challenge to not only Neil Bonnet, but to the leader, Ricky Rudd. And Bodine is looking strong here.
Boy, is he ever looking strong. If he can pass on the outside at this stage of the race, he is very, very strong.
Chevrolet catching Ricky Rudd Ford. They're in corner number two.
Talking about Ford, look at Elliott. Elliott is hanging on in there. Lots of people are running competitively up front. It does look like Bodine's the best, but Elliott is hanging right on there with the lead group.
That is Elliott there on the high side of Rusty Wallace in the number nine car. He's running the high group coming down the straightaway. He is in fourth place.
Trying to get by Rusty Wallace. Bobby Allison, meanwhile, trying to get by Bill Elliott. Allison alongside, down the back straightaway. He's alongside Elliott, but Rusty Wallace is right in front of him.
Another guy who has just crept into the picture every once in a while. The descendant of two green cars. The first one right there was Harry Gant. But Joe Ruttman, they had somewhat of a reconnoitering period during the last yellow flag session. He took a couple of extra pit stops, and the last one, which Bob told you about, all they did was clean the windshield, make sure the grill was clean. They kind of looked over the tires. They didn't do any work. They just kind of took a step back and calmed down and said, we have everything the way we want it now. And it seemed like the answer was a nodded yes. I'll tell you, I think Ruttman may be coming back to get a job.
Bodine still trailing the leader, Ricky Rudd.
And Rudd really needs to stay out front with that grill going out of his automobile. When he gets behind cars, that's when he's the most likely to get something in the radiator and break the radiator.
Good point. He needs to be in clean air to have the radiator work best for him. Now, as we look toward the sky, we think that perhaps the skies are a little bit brighter than they have been in the last hour or so. So maybe the rain is over, and maybe we can go the rest of the distance without any caution periods for rain. 285 laps completed, 115 to go in this 400 lap first Union 400.
Remember, it takes about 21, maybe 22 seconds a lap at racing speed. It gives you an idea of how much longer we have to go on this race. There is Bill Elliott, who right now works the outside of Rusty Wallace, trail Bobby Allison. The two of them trail the number three car of Dale Earnhardt, number five car of Bodine, and the 15 of Ricky Rudd. There is Elliott.
Bill Elliott finally got by the 27 car of Rusty Wallace. We saw him four or five laps ago trying to get by. He finally is by. And the green car right behind Rusty Wallace, Harry Gant. We haven't talked about Skolban today too much, but there he is right in the thick of things. Saw a little smoke coming out of the car. Didn't look good there, Bob.
Yeah, that's Harry Gant in car number 33 running sixth, and there was a little bit of smoke evident from that car last lap. Right behind Harry is Darrell Waldrop in car number 11, and right behind Darrell is Joe Ruttman. Now, this is 6th, 7th, and 8th right here.
Let me throw in a vote again for Ruttman. Remember what I told you? There he is on the screen. Now he has caught this pass. He is easily running quicker than everybody, with the possible exception of Rudd and the number five car of Bodine, who are setting the pace. But Ruttman has broke from congestion and caught the lead pack of about 10 or 12 cars, of which there are several lap cars in there.
Let's see what he can do here with Darrell Waldrop. They go down the back stretch, and Waldrop puts about two car lengths between himself and Joe Ruttman. Harry Gant in sixth place. He has steakhouse and his home not too far from this racetrack in Taylorsville, North Carolina. Ruttman now working outside of Darrell Waldrop in corner number two. Can Joe Ruttman take the spot away from Waldrop? Not right now. Well,
But look, he dives outside in turn three. He draws alongside Darrell Walter. And folks, you don't pass Junior Johnson, one of his cars at this racetrack on the outside, and Joe Rutman does it by.
Nice move by Rutman. He moves into seventh.
Plenty of time to go on this one. This racetrack has brought about some unusual races in the past with all the rain delays. We have no race record speed. In 1971 here, when Richard Petty won, they went the entire 400 laps with no caution flags. Back in also 71 was Petty won. In 67, Darrell Derringer led all 400 laps. Well, neither one of those things will happen today, but this racetrack is kind of interesting. A lot of unusual occurrences occur.
Now Dale Earnhardt again beginning to make a move. He has put himself into the third position, and right behind him is Neil Bonnet there, number 12, who is one lap down, and Tim Richmond at 25, who is two laps down. And running with Tim Richmond is, there he is, the number 22 car of Bobby Allison.
And right behind him, I don't think we get a shot. Yes, the two green cars are side by side going down in turn one.
Rutman's got another one. Rutman goes around again. He picks up one more position.
Folks, I'm sorry, but it was a very important move that Joe Rutman passed for position. He now is in sixth spot, I believe. Yes. There we see the Earnhardt car starting to pull away from Neil Bonnet.
And not only has Dale begun to pull away from Bonnet, there is Rutman, Waltrip, and Gant, but the two leaders, as we watch this group trying to make its way to the front, they have distanced themselves, Rudd and Bodine. But the story of the race may become Joe Rutman. He is certainly not in a challenging position yet, but just by eyeballing it, without having stopwatches on it, it looks like that Rutman is the guy who has the capability of coming to the front.
Joe Rutman has had his problems earlier this year. For a couple of races, they had an overheating problem. They got that ironed out. And now it appears as if Rutman may be in his best opportunity of the year to win a Winston Cup race, or possibly in his career. You can see how close he is to Bill Elliott, who is in fifth position. We'll be right back at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina Speedway for the first Union. At North Wilkesboro, where Jeff Bodine is occasionally making a bid to take over the lead from Ricky Rudd, but Rudd is hanging on at the moment as we have 100 laps to go in this 400-lap race with three-quarters finished.
It's like that Jeff Bodine follows Rudd for a lap after lap, just trying to lull into sleep. Oh, I can't pass you, Ricky. You're outrunning me. And, oh, Joe Rutman trying to pass Bill Elliott. He's going by the 27 car. Rusty Wallace on the back. Darrell Walter coming right along with it.
Well, they used Rick Baldwin. Rutman really set that move up. It took him about five laps to do it. And fortunately for him, Rick Baldwin came around in the number 64 car and allowed Joe to at least put up another lap on Wallace. Now Joe goes to the inside of Bill Elliott.
And let's see if Rutman can pick up the spot on Bill Elliott. This would put him in fifth position. They race down the back stretch. Door handle going into three. Rutman has, at least momentarily, taken over fifth position. They come out of the fourth corner, and Rutman has cleanly made the pass.
And Bill Elliott very quickly drove right in behind Joe Rutman because he did not want Darrell Walter to get by. But Bill went turn one a little bit too hard. Darrell Walter alongside him. He has position down the back straightaway, and looks like he's going to take the spot away from Bill.
So Waltrip moves to sixth, and Elliott for the moment back in seventh position.
And all that work that he did to get by the Rusty Wallace car, car 27, to no avail. Rusty is back in front of him one more time.
The lead is held by Ricky Rudd. Here he is on the fourth corner, right behind him, Jeff Bodine. We have had five different leaders and eight lead changes so far in this event. We've had seven caution periods, two of which have been because of rain. But as I mentioned earlier, the skies are not looking too bad right now.
Rudd able to keep that Ford, Motorcraft Ford, out in front of the Chevrolet of Jeff Bodine. As I said, every once in a while, Bodine will try to sneak a peek inside. Hasn't been able to work anything out so far. And Dale Earnhardt, meanwhile, is closing just ever so slightly. He has gained a few car lengths. but he still certainly is in the picture between Rudd and Bonine.
There's a good look at Ricky Rudd, the driver of car number 15, whose best finish this year has been a second at Bristol. That is the only top 10 finish he has had this year. He was just out of the top 10, 11th at the Daytona 500. Bud Moore, the crew chief on this car, is back at the racetrack after having missed a couple of races because of some hepatitis. We're certainly glad to have Bud back, and he has to be pleased with the way things are going.
You know, so many of the Winston Cup drivers are age 40 years or more, and in 15 years you figure that they won't be around. But two of the people who will be around likely, three of the people, as a matter of fact, is that man right there, one, Ricky Rudd is another, as well as Jeff Bonine. So these people represent part of the new generation that is moving up to ascend to the throne of Winston Cup racing. I don't know that even they expected it all to happen this suddenly, because the guys who are on top right now have been around for so long, but I think you're seeing a scene that you're likely to see for quite a while.
Petty and Gant were trading paint there in the fourth turn, and I thought Gant was going to lose it, but he gathered it in, but they still run side by side for eighth and ninth spots.
Now, Petty on the inside, got the board on the inside of Skull Bennett. In turn three, looks like he has a spot. Harry got much too high.
Let's replay what happened a lap ago down in the fourth corner, where they definitely did bump.
They sure did. Kyle Petty right on the inside, and they just touched the left rear, which got Harry sideways, but a great job of saving it.
Like any good race driver, what happens when you get in trouble? You keep it in the front.
Exactly right.
You know, guys, the Fords are performing very well here this afternoon. When we were in Darlington last weekend, we mentioned the fact that the Fords were not running all that well, but Ricky Rudd is the leader. Bill Elliott is up in the top 10, so is Kyle Petty. Jack, what's going on down in the pit area?
Well, I did a little unscientific survey. I went east to Kirchhoff and queried as to whether they have put on cup tires or sticker tires. Now, you remember Jim Richmond's answer. Well, all of them, right down the line, first through fifth, have chosen to go with new tires, sticker tires, in this last round of pit stops.
Well, when Tim Richmond told me that, Jackie, I assumed that everyone would be doing the same thing, that the sticker tires, the brand-new tires, tires that had never been on a race car before, were better. And you wonder, why is that? You would think that the new tires would not adhere as well that first lap or two. But, nevertheless, they do, and they do a great job of it.
Well, and I think what all of them were gambling on was forget about the initial lap. We wanted, as you know, new tires come in 10 to 15 laps after you had them on. And they figured, with the intermittent rain, we really weren't going to get racing until we had 15 or 20 laps in the book, and that's when they want the rubber on the road.
Michael Waltrip's Hawaiian Punch Pontiac is running very slowly in turn number three. As he came off of four, the car just seemed to die on him, and now it's coasting in corner number three. I think he's going to have enough momentum build up to carry him into the pit area, but it does not look good for Michael Waltrip.
Yes, he does make it on pit road, and I sure am glad, because, you know, we have a battle for the lead shaping up. Earnhardt almost has caught those front two, and when he and Jeff Bodine, when he starts trying to get Bodine, that might be just what Ricky Rudd needs to go ahead and win the race.
There is Rudd coming off the fourth corner, right behind him is Jeff Bodine, and then Dale Earnhardt in car number three.
Well, a quick rundown, an unofficial rundown between behind those first four. We've got Allison, who is not in a challenging position. Joe Rutland is fifth, by the way, on a handheld stopwatch. His ascent to the top has stabilized. It's about 4.5 seconds, and he has not moved in. Waltrip running sixth. Number nine car, Elliott, seventh. The seventh car, Kyle Petty, is eighth. Harry Gannis, ninth. And Bobby Hillen, Jr., has just gone a lap down. He continues to race in tenth, but just got lapped by the leaders, who are now together.
Nine cars on the lead lap with 80 circuits to go.
Not only are three of 10 cars in the lead lap, three of them are in the same corner. The first three car, there was the Earnhardt in the three car. Right in front of him, the yellow and white car, Jeff Bodine, the red and white car, Ricky Rudd. This is spot 1, 2, 3.
Ron Bouchard moving very high on the racetrack and allowing Ricky Rudd to pass by. And also allowing Jeff Bodine. And Bodine and Bouchard now run are once again in traffic, at least second and third place are. And Earnhardt now also puts a lap on Alex Kulwicki. And the leader, Ricky Rudd, has to contend with Jody Ridley in car number 75. That's the next car that he will be lapping as they enter turn number three. So with Ricky Rudd leading, Bodine second, Earnhardt third, we'll take this break and be right back with more of the first Union Bank 400 from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. At North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina with 330 laps completed, Ricky Rudd is the leader, Jeff Bodine is in second position, and Dale Earnhardt is in third. Fourth now belongs to Bobby Allison, and fifth is Joe Rutman. Nine cars are on the lead lap, and there are the first three, and there is the Allison and Rutman battle that's going on, and they are putting a lap on Alan Kulwicki, who is certainly very much in contention to be Rookie of the Year in 1986.
The young man has been very impressive so far, Bob. This is the only car that Alan Kulwicki has. He had this same car at Bristol. He had it at Darlington last week, and here he is at Wilkesboro, and he was the fastest qualified Ford here. Qualified about 11th. Beat Ricky Rudd, beat Bill Elliott.
And he has been the highest finishing rookie in every race that he has finished. And he's really going about this NASCAR project, I think, the way that the people down here in the South are going to pay a lot of attention to him. He's doing what he has to do. He's got one car. He does a lot of the mechanical work himself. He's very solid both on and off the racetrack. He's working very hard, and he's getting results. It looks like, Benny, also that Alan Kulwicki may be here today.
Yes, it has. It picked up some sponsorship from Winston, which is a, you know, Southeastern State chain, a steakhouse chain. It's very possible he could be here today.
Joe Rutman is letting it all hang out in his attempt to pass Bobby Allison. Rutman's rear end getting out just a little bit in corner number two. And Joe has been working on Bobby now for the last several laps, as Earnhardt is now right on the back bumper of Jeff Bodine as those two drivers go at it for second while the lead continues to be held by Rudd.
I think that Jeff Bodine, the past few laps, has looked in the rearview mirror as much as he has because he looked up, he saw Earnhardt coming. I think he's trying to keep Earnhardt behind him. They're letting Ricky Rudd just slowly drive away.
Benny, they really are. You know, those two guys, the five car and the three car, they certainly expected to be among the front runners and probably in the position that they are, fighting for the lead. I don't think they predicted, even in their own mind, that Rudd would be the one they would both be chasing.
I really don't think so. The problem Ricky Rudd has is I don't know if he can go all the way without stopping for fuel. He has been now 105 or 10 laps. He has 60 laps to go. I'm not sure Ricky Rudd can go all the way. We'll have to wait to find out. But more so, Jackie Roos, they think they can. But I'm not sure they can.
A caution flag might make the difference. Obviously, you don't burn up as much gasoline under a caution flag condition as you do green flag. So a caution flag might just be the margin. It might save them.
Well, if they have a caution flag, certainly Rudd and all the rest of the cars will go in, and Ricky will put the fuel in the car.
And we have Neil Bonnet and Doug Hebron bumping down in corner number two, but no problem as the green stays out. You know, one thing we haven't talked about is the point standing. Darrell Waltrip is the points leader with 1,000. Dale Earnhardt in second, and Earnhardt can certainly pick up some ground here toward the Winston Cup Championship, or at least for the $150,000 that'll be offered at the halfway point of the season in Winston Cup points.
And Darrell Waltrip needs to get going because Kenny Martin could probably tell us, but I don't think Darrell Waltrip has had a finish out of the top five this year. He hasn't, and right now he's in sixth spot.
He has had a third, a fifth, a fourth, a third, and second last weekend at Darlington, so he has not finished out of the top ten in the top five this year. Rudd continuing to lead in his Motorcraft Ford here at the first Union 400 at North Wilkesboro. There are the top five. Winston Cup racing on this Sunday afternoon from North Wilkesboro. Ricky Rudd in car number 15 is the leader. Second is Jeff Bodine, and you can see the interval between first and second there with 54 laps to go. Ricky beginning to stretch it out just a little bit, and also Dale Earnhardt, who is in third position, is falling back a little bit to Jeff Bodine as we widen out and show you the interval between second and third. And there it is, not nearly as close as it was just a few laps ago. A week from today, well, Larry Newber, who is in the booth with me here this weekend, will have the Formula One race from Imola in Italy, the San Marino Grand Prix, as we continue to cover all of the Formula One races in 1986.
Ricky Rudd, who has never won here at North Wilkesboro, although he is 11th on the all-time money winner list at this racetrack, has had two crashes so far in the 1986 season, so he would really like to redeem for that. But he finished second at Bristol two races ago, and as we told you earlier in the broadcast, I think we're looking as much at the expertise of Ricky on a short track as we are his car owner and team manager and chief mechanic, cook and bottle washer, Bud Moore. He's been around a long time, been racing as a race driver, as a team owner, as a chief mechanic. He started out on this type of racetrack, and I think his experience really shows on these short tracks where you've got such a delicate touch that you have to execute in order to be competitive.
It sure is just a delicate touch. That's very well put, Larry Newber, because off these corners, I've been watching these fellas come off the corner. We're watching Ricky Rudd going to turn three. Now, as he exits the corner, it's almost like he's tiptoeing off that corner, just using the throttle ever so gradually, trying to get off the corner with the best line so that he won't use up the tire. There we see Bobby Allison and Joe Rutman. Rutman still trying to get by the Bobby Allison Miller American. That's the battle of the Buicks. Two Buick automobiles right there.
Yeah, they've been going at it for several laps, and Rutman just cannot pass Allison. So Allison holds on to that fourth place with Joe Rutman fifth.
North Wilkesboro is one of the two so-called charter members of NASCAR racing history in the major leagues. We got a spin.
Dave Marcus slams the wall in turn number two, and he hit it pretty hard because he has knocked off the back bumper on that car, and it appears to be a rather hard impact that Dave Marcus has had in turn number one. The car is resting between turns one and two, and now this makes things rather interesting because it will allow Rudd to come in for the fuel that there was some question about, and it may tighten this field up considerably. Here is Marcus in corner number one.
Looks like he got in the corner, just a little bit too hard. There could have been a flat tire or something that caused the problem. But he went down in turn one, got the back end of the wall, and the front end came around.
And the leaders are on pit road. Let's go to Jackaroo, who's with Ricky Rudd.
Ricky Rudd needs to go to work immediately, filling it up with fuel, taking a look at changing all four tires. That's what they're going to do. They've accomplished the task on the outside. They moved to the inside to exchange the tires. Just as we went on the air, we were also notified that TRW have awarded $1,000 to Bud Moore as the TRW mechanic of the race. He does his work in quick fashion and puts him back out onto the racetrack.
Dale Earnhardt is going to lead, though, the contention out of the pit area. Earnhardt is going to be first, Rudd second, Bodine third, then Kyle Petty, Bobby Allison, and Joe Rutman. That's the way they're going to line up for the restart here in a few laps. Benny, it seems to be like you guys, when you come in for a pit stop and you change all four tires, that wait must be the longest that you can imagine.
Well, it depends on how hot it is. If it's very, very hot outside, it's not very long because you want to get about two big cups of water to drink. And you very seldom, it takes about four tire stops to drink the two cups. If it's a very cool day and you really don't need a drink, you're right. It seems like an eternity. I just see Dave Marcus moving around over there inside his car. Evidently, he sent the ambulance away.
Well, he did go in hard. The Helen Ray Special is one of the most unusual sponsors in Winston Cup racing today. That's one lady, a lady about 60 years of age, who lives out in the Southwest, who has developed a very keen interest, obviously, in Winston Cup stock car racing. And she has decided that she wants to be a part of this, and she is fall apart in a way that she doesn't want to be today.
With 356 laps completed, we are under caution because of an accident in corner number one involving Dave Marcus. We'll be back with our coverage after these messages. The weather had to turn sour on us. It was so beautiful on Thursday, or rather Friday and Saturday here, but today it's chilly enough to bring out the blankets, and of course we have had some rain here at North Wilkesboro earlier in the day. Well, coming up, well, we still are under caution, and they're still cleaning up the debris over in corner number one caused by the Dave Marcus accident. So we will take another break and then be back with some racing. Stay with us. Some 20- 26,500 fans on hand here at North Wilkesboro for the First Union 400, stop number 7 on the Winston Cup Trail for this year. Situation is we are under yellow because of an accident involving this car and driver, Dave Marcus. He's okay, and the car is on the hook being brought back into the pit area. The leader is going to be Dale Earnhardt when we resume racing, with Ricky Rudd in second, Jeff Bodine third, then Bobby Allison and Joe Ruttman. The attrition here has not been all that great today. Only six cars have officially dropped out of competition, namely Trevor Boyes, Richard Petty, Terry Labonte, J.D. McDuffie, Dave Marcus, and the number 23 car of Michael Waltrip. Those six cars, the only ones to drop out, 24 of the original 30, still running. And they're lining up for a restart.
Bob, in addition to the five guys that you just mentioned, four others remain on the lead lap in order: Darrell Waltrip, Kyle Petty, Harry Gant, and Bill Elliott. One lap down, Bobby Hillen Jr., Neil Bonnet, Rusty Wallace. Two laps down, Tim Richmond. They comprise the top 13. In no particular order, the other cars still on the racetrack: Kenny Schrader and Judy Dunlevy, number 90, Willie T. Ribbs, Doug Heverin, Jody Ridley, Morgan Shepherd. Remember, he's in James Hilton's car this week. Jimmy Means, Ron Bouchard, Buddy Arrington, Alan Kowicki. Looks like he's going to be the top finishing rookie again.
Tim Richmond moving alongside Dale Earnhardt for the restart of this race. Tim has been unable to make up the laps that he lost very early in this contest. And so the green comes out once again. We go back to racing on lap number 360. We've got 40 to go. Everybody with a full load of fuel and hopefully the tires they want to end the race on. But Dale Earnhardt right now is just pulling away from everybody else.
He sure is. He's putting lots and lots of distance on Ricky Rudd. He's having trouble. Rudd's having trouble getting by the Rusty Wallace automobile. Rudd gets by. Now Jeff Bodine, he's on the outside of Wallace. And behind them, the 26 car, Joe Ruttman, alongside Bobby Allison for fourth spot.
And finally, Joe Ruttman takes the position away from Bobby Allison. Those two have been fighting out there on the racetrack for numerous laps, and now Ruttman has passed Bobby Allison, and Joe Ruttman has moved himself into fourth place.
In some respects, it's a shame that Tim Richmond and Rusty Wallace are up there. They certainly deserve to be up there, but we have five guys in the lead lap, and they were ready to shoot it out, draw one-on-one against each other for the win. But Tim Richmond and Rusty Wallace, they still have their hands to play, too. They're running competitively. Had they not lost those laps, unfortunately, early on, they'd be right up there going for the win.
Dave Marcus is okay. Let's go down to Jackaroo for a conversation with him.
And he's still in his Helen Ray special, and it looks as if you got it both in the front and the back, Dave.
Yeah, Jackie, the throttle hung up. I really don't know why. Ice made high. Most of Bobby and them guys by on the inside because it looked like they were running better down there. I let up on it to go into one. It just hung wide open. I had the brakes locked up and just kept going right straight on into the wall. I really don't know why.
Real quickly, who would you pick to win today with what you saw?
Well, Earnhardt's running good towards Ricky Rudd. A minute ago, was running real good, but new tires are going to change all that.
Well, we'll just have to watch it unfold in the remaining laps, guys.
Yeah, I think that's a very important point. New tires are going to maybe mean the difference in who wins this race. They come off the fourth corner. That's Tim Richmond tucked right in behind Dale Earnhardt, but Richmond is two laps down. Behind Richmond is Ricky Rudd, and then Jeff Bodine. Bodine and Rudd touchdown in corner one.
Just during the last couple laps, visual observation, Earnhardt is not the fastest car in that top five quintet. Is it Rudd? Is it Bodine? Is it Ruttman? It might be Richmond. Then it's not Dale Earnhardt.
This race is too close to call. Who knows right now? You're exactly right. Ruttman has gained on those fellas, but now he's drifting back a couple of Charlie. Ricky Rudd, they closed the gap on Dale Earnhardt. But is Earnhardt trying to keep his tires cool? Who knows what he's trying to do? Maybe he's just trying to take it easy.
This race is far from over, and we only have a little more than 30 laps to go. It is anybody's race.
And folks, Tim Richmond just moved over. He let the other four cars go by. He said, okay, you guys are racing for the lead. I'm two laps down. Go ahead. Very gently moved by Tim Richmond.
Boy, it really was. What a fine moment this race has been.
Ruttman in fourth place. It's been a great afternoon for Joe Ruttman, with the exception of an incident down in corner number three in which he got tangled up with another car and spun. But it has been a fine performance by
you tack on to try and get by. You're really at a deficit with such a short number of laps to go.
Wow. Earnhardt trying to take an inside groove away. The last time Ricky Rudd was able to get alongside of him, Earnhardt going down on the racetrack. He's going to leave the outside wide open. But Rudd, I don't think he would have tried on the outside. Jeff Bodine, he might. And Joe Rubin, he might.
27 laps to go this time around. Who has got enough time to do all the maneuvering they want?
This is such a difficult racetrack to pass on. It really is. And Rudman perhaps has the fastest car. Maybe it's Bodine, but that is not really the story. The story is being able to pass the car in front of you.
The story is right now exactly, Bob. The story is who's going to win the race.
Well, yeah.
The first four running nose to tail on the racetrack.
And, you know, let's give a mention, because behind all this, about 10 car lengths away, is Darrell Walters. He is fifth. He's the lead lap. And you know what? Before this thing's over, he's going to be up there mixing up with.
Wait a minute. What were we talking about? About top five finishes? About trying out the seat? One, two, three. My goodness, he's fifth again.
That's exactly right. Darrell has moved up into the top five. And look at Rudman go outside of Jeff Bodine in corner two. No luck there, though. And that sixth car there in the line behind the lap car of Tim Richmond is Darrell Waltrip, who is fifth. And now Tim moves high, allowing Darrell to go underneath. And another gentlemanly move by Tim Richmond. And now we have the first five cars running right together.
Wow, what an automobile race. I certainly hope none of the fans left this Speedway when it rained back about 100 laps ago, because they are missing a thriller.
It really complicates things for Joe Rutman now. He's obviously working all over the back lid of Jeff Bodine, but now he's got to start watching for Waltrip, because one half of an inch of a slip, and Waltrip's got it like right here, maybe.
There goes Waltrip on the inside of Rutman going in turn.
Oh, and Joe! Sideways. I thought he was going to lose it again. He does lose the position, but he kept control of the race car.
As I would say.
So Waltrip moves up into fourth, Rutman back to fifth.
You know, that's the problem that everyone has right now. They've all got to protect their back door as well as try to pass that guy in front of them. I don't know what to do. This is a tough spot. Who knows what to do? Meanwhile, Earnhardt putting a couple of car lengths on. Dale Earnhardt putting a couple of car lengths on Ricky Rudd.
Here's the replay of the Waltrip and Rutman incident.
Darrell just touched the left rear of the Rutman car enough that it got Joe a little bit sideways. He had to go up the hill. He did do a good job saving the car, but meanwhile, Darrell Walters got by.
Well, we've got a situation here where it certainly does not look like that Earnhardt is the best on the track right now, but because there's so much going on and so much at stake, and they award him the win. We're coming up on slower traffic. They are going to approach them in two or maybe three laps. This might be the difference.
All right, before we get to the lap traffic, let's make predictions. Larry, who's going to win the race?
Dale Earnhardt.
Benny.
Dale Earnhardt.
Jackaroo in the pit area. Who's going to win this race, in your opinion?
Boy, that would be a tough call right now.
Good. I'm going to pick Dale Earnhardt to hold on here. They are approaching some slower cars now. The first they'll try to pass is Rick Baldwin in car number 64. And that should be this lap. The top five running right together.
Go back and mention again that everybody has won a race except the fifth running Joe Rutman. So sentimentally, you really have to lean in Joe's favor, but it's beginning to look pretty bleak for him running in fifth with inside of 20 laps to go.
But look at Rudd beginning to show some muscle now. Right on the back bumper of Dale Earnhardt. Let's see what happens as they work the traffic now down the backstretch. Buddy Arrington is the car they're lapping.
You know, this thing is getting more confused in every lap that they run, because I thought just a moment ago that Earnhardt was pulling away from Rudd, but now.
No way.
Rudd right on his back bumper.
Yep.
And interestingly, Jeff Bodine, if the experience of 1986 would have been any indication, would have expected him to be at the front, not near it, but at the front. But Rudd and Earnhardt are definitely burying him right now. He looks like he's out of it. He's holding back Waltrip and Joe Rutman.
Rick Willie T. Ribbs is the car ahead of Earnhardt. Ribbs going low on the racetrack, and Dale Earnhardt and Ricky Rudd. front, both passing him.
And Joe Ruffin trying to make another move again. Ruffin is just behind those two cars you're looking at. He's trying the outside of Waltrip. There you see him.
There they are, Bodine, Waltrip, and Ruttman. That's third, fourth, and fifth. Now Ruttman looking outside, but there is a slower car to the inside of the racetrack. That is Chet Phillips at number 81.
Bodine is winning this race for either Earnhardt or Rudd. Bodine's holding everybody up.
It looks that way because Jeff Bodine, the pole sitter, had the fastest car several times today during the race. Right now, it does not seem that his car can keep up with the 3 and the 15 of Rudd. There we see Jeff Bodine, Darrell Walton right on his rear bumper, and Joe Ruffin right on his back bumper.
Perhaps the last time we'll get an opportunity to mention it, but I think Willie T has run a very nice race here today. He's kept out of the way of the leaders. He has spun a couple of times, but that's something that comes with experience. And Willie T, I'm sure, is going to be back in Winston Cup racing.
Hey, Benny, we saw how much promise Rusty Wallace had when he came to this league. It would have taken like 91 races before he finally won. It doesn't happen the first month you arrive.
It doesn't happen overnight. That's for doggone sure. Willie T Ribs has won in other sections. In other groups of racing, I'm sure he'll win here.
There he is. Willie T. Ribb from San Jose, California, started 29th in today's grid and is still on the racetrack in competition. There is the interval between first and second. Bobby Dillon is being lapped once again. Now Rudd goes inside, but no room there, and he has to stay back in second position.
10 laps to go. 10 laps on this track, it's like going down to the end of the street. It happens real quick, even though it takes 21 seconds to go around and you skate at this position on the racetrack and make the race, it goes by quickly. Then.
It sure does. But it's not going to go by quickly for Dale Earnhardt because he still has Rudd in the rearview mirror. And I think that a clean, green racetrack, clear racetrack that Earnhardt can keep Rudd by. But that always that problem of passing cars, the traffic situation that they run across. And which way does he choose? The inside or the outside? How can he keep Rudd behind him? That's all the things that's going through Dale Earnhardt's mind right now. The next 10 laps is going to be a long, long time.
Go nine, Walter Rudd. Third, fourth, fifth. They continue to run in that order. Joe Ruttman going high of Darrell Waltrip. And we have the report once again that sprinkles are beginning to be felt in the pit area. Should Dale Earnhardt win today's race, it will end two streaks. It will end the 11th different winner in 11 races over two seasons. And it will also be our first repeat winner of 1986.
Because Dale Earnhardt won last week in Darlington, South Carolina.
Dale Earnhardt, there is so much riding on the next month or so for Dale Earnhardt. He asserted himself last week. I think he silenced a lot of the complaints and criticism from episodes earlier this year. He won so smashing last week. But there have to be a lot of journalists who are watching this one carefully. How will he handle the situation with Ricky Rudd should Ricky get alongside? Ricky's a pretty big favorite down here. So is Dale. So there's going to be a lot of feelings on both sides.
Five laps to go.
The problem is, Dale Earnhardt, I don't think he's going to let Ricky Rudd get alongside of him unless he does it on the outside. He'll give Ricky the outside of the racetrack, and I don't think Ricky can do anything with it out there. But he's got four laps to find out, and we'll find out.
Once again, we watch this battle for third in fourth position. Now we're back up front to the leaders. And there is the interval between second and third position. So it's been basically a two-car race. It's going to come down to that, to the checkered flag. Will it be Dale Earnhardt or will it be Ricky Rudd, Chevy or Ford?
If they were qualifying, Ricky Rudd is faster. This is not qualifying.
Now we have just three laps to go. Down the backstretch. It's Earnhardt still leading. Four or five car lengths now on Ricky Rudd.
Dale keeps it right on. He's sure to keep it on the bottom of the racetrack. Costing time around the racetrack, but he knows that's the spot that Ricky Rudd can get by the easiest. He has to cover that spot first.
Next time around, it'll be the white flag. Just one more lap to go.
And not a good set of turns the last time. Through one and two for Ricky Rudd. You can see he lost about a car length, and a car length is almost as good as a lap at this juncture of the race.
The white flag is out. One more lap to go. We'll watch Dale Earnhardt and Ricky Rudd. Down in turn number two now. Rudd hangs onto the lead. They come off the second corner and down the backstretch.
Earnhardt lengthens his lead to about five car lengths. They're in turn three. Now turn four, off the corner. Dale Earnhardt wins the first Union 400. Rudd finishes second. Here comes Bodine in third, then Waltrip, and then Joe Rudman. And the Wrangler crew celebrates a victory. Dale Earnhardt has won his second consecutive Winston Cup race. Last weekend at Darlington on the My Bank Super Speedway, and now on the short track here at North Wilkesboro.
That last caution flag really set up the opportunity for drama, guys, but Dale Earnhardt made it anticlimactic, didn't he?
He sure did.
Earnhardt has just, as I mentioned at the very beginning of the show, the most dominant car by far on the Winston Cup circuit this year. Proves again today. These fellas have got some work cut out for them. They're going to beat that Wrangler machine in 1986.
You are absolutely right. Now, Dale went into this race in second position in the Winston Cup points, about 48 behind Darrell Waltrip. And that gap is going to narrow because of Earnhardt's win here at North Wilkesboro. So Jackaroo has made his way to victory lane, and as soon as Dale gets unstrapped, we'll move in to talk with him, and we'll do that in a moment. Today's winner...
And it looks, Dale Earnhardt, like you don't ever want to give up victory lane. A win in Darlington and now a win in North Wilkesboro. Congratulations.
Thank you, Jackie. And it's a nice place to be, you know. Good Lord, let's get by without rain today and a safe race. And, you know, the car did pretty good all day. We had real good pit stops. The guys were just super in the pits. And, you know, it's just a great day for us. I'd like to apologize to Joe Ruttman and the Quaker State crew because I jumped up under him in the traffic over there. A car just went under him, and I stuck my nose in, and he came down, and we clipped him, and we both just about spun out. He did, but, you know, that was more or less my fault. I should have probably waited a little more, but a car just passed him, and I thought I could get in there with him, too, but, I just run out of room there, so, you know, sorry to Joe. I think he come back and finish fourth, didn't he?
When you take a look in your rearview mirror near the end of the race and you kept seeing Ricky Rudd just stalking you, looking for a miscue, were you concerned at all?
Well, I was because he's running so strong before that last pit stop, but we got a good combination on the tires, and I could, you know, keep the car down and run a low groove, and, you know, Rick and I had the best cars. He's run good all year long. They've had some trouble, and I was glad to see them finish good, but I was worried about him. I didn't know whether I had enough to beat him or not. I had to wait to the last.
Well, gentlemen, they say cream rises to the top, and that seems to be the case here today in Victory Lane in North Wilkesboro.
Our congratulations from the booth to Dale Earnhardt, winner of our race here today. And the top 10 finishers show that in second position was Ricky Rudd, finishing third, Jeff Bodine. Fourth was Darrell Waltrip, and fifth, Joe Ruttman. Six through 10, finishing in sixth position was Bobby Allison, then Harry Gant, seventh, Kyle Petty, eighth, Bill Elliott, ninth, and Rusty Wallace finished in 10th place. The race summary shows us that Earnhardt led 195 laps, the margin of victory about a car length. The average speed was 88.4 miles an hour, and the race took 2 hours, 49 minutes, and 39 seconds. Now, we will have all of the results from the world of auto racing on